You're live. Go to Twitter. Go to Tumblr. Advertise.
Who the fuck uses Tumblr?
I do. Lots it's only because I've got over 700 followers.
I'll link the Twitch in here and
You're
I'll
live.
Put it on
go
my
to
Twitter.
Go to Tumblr. Oh, and I'm doing the echo because I forgot to mute my stream. Wow, botches already.
Hello, my name is TeamCritic12K, and you're watching Botchamania, the Twitch version.
What the fuck? He got a bathicle! Wanna play 21? Jesus! Jeff Harvey, -5 stars! Here comes Mongo. I'm in the danger zone.
Oh my gosh.
Super Dragon!
It's Calcos O'Clock.
Yes, everybody, advertise, do stuff and things. Go to Skype and Discord and tell all
I'm
your
already
friends.
Going to my friends.
Okay.
All right.
I actually got to go to Facebook and get Gabe because Silver is here, so I don't need to get him. I also need to get Kirk, assuming he's available, and he should be. It's Friday night, so he's not working.
Hello to all you lovely people. Hope y'all are doing well. We're just getting the tournament thingy set up.
Posting this shit on Twitter. Maybe we'll get like 5 more viewers.
Maybe. Just only a maybe. It's not a definitive just yet.
We won't know it until it happens.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah, I'll just post it. Commentating over some fake wrestling.
And I should get Steven AD on this as well. And then I need to tell this group that it's happening.
Looking around and trying to find all my wrestling fans. All
right. So I am done. We have 1 minute, and then showtime starts.
Da 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 da. Great. Now that's stuck in my head. Fuck.
What?
Brody Quest. Fucking.
Oh, is. Okay.
All right,
you know what Brody Quest is. Dun 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 dun
dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun dun. That was viral way the fuck back in like 2008. It's an old meme. Stop quoting it.
But it's great though. It's so catchy.
No.
It's better than some fucking memes we have right now, like fucking
no.
Dicks Out for Harambe.
Dicks Out for Harambe is the greatest meme ever, and right now, in retaliation, I'm going to get my dick out for Harambe. I'm also going to get my dick out for the Haymakers Tournament Spectacular, which is starting now! Greetings, everybody. My name is Kalkos, and joining me is Toon Critic on my left and Geeky Steven on my right. Guys, I cannot tell you how excited I am for this to finally be happening. I have been waiting and trying and working and bleeding and sweating and tearing up for over 100 hours of in-game time and overall work on trying to make this the best possible tournament that it can be. I have worked long, I have worked hard, and I want to make this the greatest thing ever. I know for a fact that it won't be, but I want to at least try.
You want to at least feel important, Michael.
Damn it, we can try.
We
Let's
can try.
Go.
So, Toon Critic, make a greeting. Do a thing.
What is up, cult personality in the house? I am super excited to be here for this. This is going to be the biggest WWE 2K16 tournament of all time. Specifically because I'm here in it. But everybody else is pretty cool too.
Okay, so before Geeky Steven, would you like to say a few words?
Hi. My name's Geeky Steven. This is technically my return to the Haymakers since Kalkos's last video fucked up. But
I will get to that later. There's actually canonical things that happen in that video that's important for this tournament that I have to explain later because the video is gone. It's not working. It's completely corrupted, and there's nothing I can do about it. It's unfortunate, but it is what it is, so I'll have to explain it later. It involves the formation of a new championship, one that you guys have not seen, and in fact you will not see until near the end of the tournament bracket tonight, which kind of sucks, but it is what it is. So we're going to go over the bracket really quick, just as a refresher for the rest of you. This is the bracket that you see right here. Specifically, this is the round of 16 bracket. Now, this tournament is a double elimination tournament for the Haymakers World Championship, which is currently held by Gabriel, you can see on the right-hand side of the bracket. Now, double elimination means that if your favorite loses, it doesn't really matter right now, because everybody starts in the winner's bracket by default. If you lose once, you move to the loser's bracket and start on a new path with the rest of the match, the initial match losers. If you lose a second time, then you are out of the tournament. So, if you lose tonight, if your favorite loses tonight, it is not the end of the world. They will get a second chance at redemption. Now, your first match, which is going to be playing very soon, is Nikki V versus Silverstone. After that is Bobby versus Acharki, then Stephen AD, Kirk Davis, and then we have a rivalry match between Toon Critic and James the Squirrel Theorist. After that is myself, Kalkos, versus Geeky Steven, and then Junkachu versus Bucky Dangerously. Gabriel, your current champion, versus newcomer Nelson Demifer, and Voice of Reason versus Josh Scorcher. That is our bracket for tonight. That is our match order for tonight. And I think it is good to get started. Are you guys all ready? Are you guys all set?
I've been born ready, man. I'm excited for this.
Geeky Steven, you got everything going?
I'm all for this, I think.
All right.
Let's friggin' go.
All right.
I'm ready with the video.
Press in 3, 2, 1, go.
Oh, let's go, man.
Whew. First match, Nikki versus Silverstone. I cannot wait.
All right. Remember, no talking until Kalkos talks.
No, you can hear it.
Oh.
Yep, I put it in. You can hear it now. Yeah!
I am muted for the sake of not risking echo, so.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, representing the Kings of the South, weighing in at 198 pounds, he is one half of the Haymakers Tag Team Champions, Nikki V.
For those of you who missed it initially, we ran a tag team exhibition between four tag teams from eight veterans. Nikki and Bobby, the Kings of the South, ended up the victors, and as such, they are your Haymakers Tag Team Champions.
Yeah, it was a pretty fun tournament, seeing Nikki and Bobby, like, blaze their way through. Like, the ending match was really intense, I gotta say.
His friggin' fuzzy things on his neck still fuck me up, though. I love that.
And his opponent, from Brooklyn, New York, representing the Vanguards, weighing in at 194 pounds, Silverstone!
I also want to mention real quick, the voice that you hear at the beginning of each match is actually Bobby, our graphics designer. He did all of the announcing work because he is a trained announcer. So I asked him, like, hey, you want to do it? And he said, sure. So he recorded a whole bunch of different prompts for each match. So it's going to be, we actually have ring announcing now. We don't have to worry about hearing Lillian, which means then we have to hear Cole, Lawler, and JBL. All right, this is awesome. I did so much to make this as good as possible, but now we finally get to start the first match, Silverstone versus Nikki. And away we go.
Indeed.
Also, people in the stream, I haven't been able to test audio, so if there's an audio problem, like if the game is too loud, or if we're too loud, or something like that, please, in the chat, let me know.
It's off to a good start. Nikki seems to be taking the lead. The nice little bar up there.
Well, right now the advantage is on Nikki's side because they're in the chain wrestling phase, and this is something that Nikki is very good at. He's a slippery little toad, that one. He's very hard to catch. But the thing is, Silverstone has plenty of high-flying moves in his arsenal. In fact, his major signature is the coast-to-coast, made famous by Shane McMahon, and his finisher is a renamed shooting star press called the Silver Star Press, named by Silverstone himself. He only won with it once. He usually wins with the Snapmare driver, but he uses the Silver Star Press to really finish off opponents when he needs to. But now we have Silverstone in a submission hold by Nikki, trying to weaken up the neck and lower back regions with that. Ooh, chest slap! Woo!
Nice. See, the thing is, there is a reason that Silver was able to get to the finals. This guy has a lot of skill behind him, I think. Usually high-flying seems to work in these type of environments, but Nikki also has a fair share of high-flying, so it's going to be interesting to see how these two are able to fare against each other, and see, Nikki's got a good start so far. Oh,
what's he doing here?
What is it?
Oh!
On the apron.
Follow-away slam on the apron.
That's the hardest part of the ring right there.
As is mentioned every single time Kevin Owens or Sami Zayn does anything ever...
Seems like you're taking things pretty much outside at this point.
Oh, right there! Nikki says, anything you can do, I can do better. Counters an arm drag into an arm drag.
Slap into a punch, and he just drives his face down in the mat.
And now Silver think that's enough to win by count out. Ref's count is up to 6.
No.
Not even close.
Like this.
Yeah, not even close. Ooh, great earth clip kick right there from Nikki.
And nice. Taking him down.
Oh,
right, Nikki's looking
looks
for...
Looks like he's already going for the top.
No, that was a middle rope senton. Middle rope senton from Nikki right there. Fantastic.
Taken to the center of the ring for something. Oh, good old-fashioned German suplex.
Made famous by Brock Lesnar, and by made famous, I mean abused to the point where we're tired of it.
Yeah, seriously. Oh, he's taking him up again for another slam.
This match seems to have been firmly in Nikki's control since the offset.
Yeah, Nikki seems to be really dominant here, but Silverstone, I don't think he's ever been... He's usually against dominant opponents. In the last tournament, I mean, he eliminated Kalkos, who was that kind of dominant performance. And I don't mean dominance in stats, because he did only win one match. It's more like imposing stature. Kalkos was railing on Silver for a very long time, but Silver was able to pull up the win either way. Oh, Jesus!
Nice little roll there into a kick.
So with Silverstone, it's all about lasting. It's just about lasting and being patient. If you can take all of the pain, then you can execute a move that just kills your opponent, and then you're done. If you last long enough and be patient enough, you can wait for that one opening that allows you to win the match.
Oh. Hurricane Rana, very nice.
Oh, and now Silverstone goes for the pin. First pinfall of the night? No.
Not even close.
Another drop kick. He seems to be working on some pretty strong kicks. If it's not a kick to the chest, it's a drop kick to the back.
It's the midsection. Silverstone's really trying to get that midsection going. I have no idea what happened there.
Silver vaulting over Nikki.
There's that submission hold again.
But he's right by the ropes.
I know, for some strange reason, Nikki didn't grab the ropes, and I don't know why.
Another snapmare.
Right there again.
Oh.
Chain wrestling going on now.
Yes, and that actually is not a good strategy by Silver, but it seems to be working now. Again, as I mentioned previously, Nikki is good at this. He's able to get out of things, but maybe not this time.
I wouldn't count Nikki out just yet.
No! Oh. Perfect. Oh, good straight jab!
Yeesh.
Remember, Silver has... Oh, wow! Jesus, right into a... Whoa! What an incredible move right there, but Nikki says no almost immediately. Not even enough time to lock it in properly. And again, Nikki's going for that move a lot.
That seems to be a trademark of Nikki, that sort of slam.
Absolutely. It's sort of like how Triple H tried to make... Oh my god, he's going for it! That's the Gutbuster! Gutbuster from Nikki! That is one of his signatures right there. Huge! Absolutely huge maneuver. He could get a win off of this right here. Nikki goes for the cover. Hooks the leg. No, not good enough.
He's taking him up again, and... Oh!
Wow, good power move from Nikki. Oh, he is setting it up.
Oh, he's getting ready for something.
He is setting it up right here. Oh, he's going to win off of this. The Emerald Fusion!
Oh! And he busted him open.
Brutal!
Just
Emerald Fusion, Jesus.
Oh, and Nikki follows it up with a springboard moonsault. A springboard moonsault. He doesn't even go for the pin. He wants to beat him up. Yeah, he just wants to beat him up, man. He doesn't even want to go for a pin.
Okay, he's just going to go after the arm.
Why don't you guys sit before? Sylvester's really good at, like, or...
Silver.
It's geek o'clock. Silver is really good at taking pain. So maybe Nikki's trying to, like, wear him down. Make sure he can't get up for that three count.
And Silverstone is just completely out of it. Nikki takes advantage and brings him to the top rope. What's he got here?
Can you imagine if, like, Silver, who made it all the way to, like, the end of the last...
Oh, Jesus! Avalanche, Falcon Arrow.
The end of the last tournament, and he gets eliminated in the first round?
He can't get eliminated, but he can go to... No, it's not good enough. He can go to the loser's bracket, and that would be... That would actually be big, but remember, it wouldn't be that big of an upset because Nikki was able to make it all the way to winner's finals. In fact, it took the grand finalists, Silver and Gabe, to knock him out. And now Silver's going for what I explained before. Shades of Shane O'Mac here. He's going for the coast to coast.
Oh, right in the side.
He is going to need some surgery after that. Cover.
He'll be feeling that in the morning.
No, not good enough.
He's going to feel all on his left or right side.
The blood in his eyes, he could still see what the heck he was doing. Ooh! Very nice DDT there.
Silverstone.
The fact that he's able to come from this speed.
Oh, and Nikki's looking for it. Yes! Nikki looks to rally right here.
Whoop.
Oh, backbreaker.
Tilt a world backbreaker.
Oh, and Nikki's looking for another one. Gut check.
Another one.
Maybe enough. Cover here.
Nope.
No.
Silver's still hanging in there.
Seemed to have gotten up quicker that time.
Yeah, no kidding. Very interesting. No, he's doing it again. Emerald Fusion.
Oh,
that's it. That's gotta be it. He's out.
This is like a burning hammer on steroids. This is over.
Whoa!
Yes! Nikki has won! Nikki gets his win back against Silver! Unbelievable! That finisher right there is... That finisher is gonna... No kidding. That finisher right there is the perfect update that Nikki needed. Nikki had the Dude Buster before, but it certainly didn't look devastating. Well, now the Emerald Fusion certainly fucking does.
Wow. Congrats to Nikki.
Well done to Nikki right there. And as we see some of the highlights, of course, both these guys tried doing really big moves on each other, and it did not work initially. Of course, both these guys' hardy competitors were able to make it very far in the last tournament. Evidenced by the fact that he needed two Emerald Fusions. Not one. Two. And this is the second one.
He got busted open.
Look at this. That is a modified version of the Brain Buster that I don't think anyone would ever take on anyone else in real life.
Here is your winner, Nikki V.
Yeah, I think Nikki was in like a totally different state in this one.
Regardless, Nikki here wins the match, and he moves on to the second winner's bracket. Congratulations to him. Well done. Well deserved. Absolutely fantastic. All right. Also, Geeky, because you have the video muted, remember.
Yeah.
All right, so...
All right, so...
Just going to check with everybody. Is there any audio edits or audio boosting that we need to do for anybody? Do we need to turn the game volume down or up or anything like that? Let us know.
Please. We're going to get started on the second match very soon. I'm going to check right now in our special room. Let's see here. Give me 1 second.
Game volume could be slightly louder.
Game volume could be louder. Okay, you two, bring your mic levels down just a hair.
All right.
Because to boost,
how does this sound?
That's perfect, because boosting game audio means I boost you as well. So, yeah.
All right.
That is important. All right, so Toon, I'm going to be swapping you out, but don't worry, this won't be the last that we hear of Toon. So, Toon, see you later on tonight.
Yep.
Can I say how funny it is that most of this seems to be taking place if the tile card thing is anything to go by? It's all taking place at SummerSlam 91.
Yeah, it's because that's the theme that I used for the arena, kind of just because I like it. James, are you there?
Yes, I am. Tell me if I need to change my sound settings. I will work on that now.
Nope, you are perfectly okay. You sound very similar in volume and tone to Toon, so you're all set. James, we are on match 2. Bobby versus Acharki, that's the next one. Get that one ready.
Let me just find where I put the folder, which is probably in downloads, because I downloaded it.
I'm just watching it from the friggin' email.
Alright.
I mean, it's keeping up alright.
James, why don't you take a minute and just introduce yourself?
Hello, I'm James the Squirrel Theorist. I'm facing Toon later, and, well, I'm obviously going to win again. But I'm also Yes, I am going there already. But I'm also a referee at a local wrestling indie fed in Australia, which is incredibly fun. We actually have a show pretty much straight after this, so I'm doing commentary here, and then I'm counting to three. A lot.
Well, speaking of Australia, fun fact for the viewers at home, James the Squirrel Theorist is the only non-American tournament participant. He is the only one. So he is not just fighting for the glory of Australia, he is fighting for the glory of the world. If only because America! Fuck yeah!
Even though we have more problems than we'd like to admit.
100%.
Yeah, that's right, I said it.
No more politics. Let's get on to the second match. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. So, 3, 2, 1, go. All right, so the second match is going to be Babe versus Acharki.
What? What was with the accent?
I don't know.
Oh,
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from Denton, Texas, weighing in at 244 pounds, representing the Kings of the South, he is one half of the Haymakers Tag Team Champions, Bobby!
So Bobby is announcing himself from another dimension. Isn't that fucking weird?
I'm more surprised he's walking out like he's a prize fighter. I mean, he's looking ripped and ready to go for this.
No, it's clearly Bobby pre-recorded his entrance. Or we could just say he has a mic.
Give me a fucking mic!
It's like he has one of those like little mic implants put into his brain. And he can just think that he's announcing himself.
With Bobby's character... Sorry, go ahead.
If they still had Mr. Kennedy's entrance, we could have just said that.
Yeah.
But...
With Bobby's character, he just kind of looks how he turned out. Like, with Bobby, I was just kind of like, okay, shortish hair, kind of a baby face. And then the body just kind of turned out the way it did. And then the outfit went with the body, so there you go. Oh, that fucking smirk, though. Jesus.
Looking incredibly confident here.
Yeah, dude.
Let's see if he can back it up.
Against this man right here.
And his opponent, from Cincinnati, Ohio, representing the Vanguards, weighing in at 217 pounds, a Charkey.
Now, a Charkey is winless in the tag team Haymakers Tournament Spectacular. He has not won any matches. He lost first to, I believe, Nikki, and then lost again to myself, Kalkos. But in the Haymakers Tag Team Exhibition, he won all of his primary placing matches with Silverstone. Now, some may say that Silverstone carried a Charkey to that point. I would have to disagree. I believe that Acharki's losses were, in fact, a fluke, and that Bobby should not be so confident. But Bobby is also the hero of the loser's bracket. He was put into the loser's bracket very early on in the last tournament, and he won more matches there than anybody else. But away we go. Bobby versus Acharki.
So what I find interesting, real quick, is... if Bobby wins, he's facing his tag team partner.
That is correct. Yes, that is correct, because Nikki won the last match, and per winner's bracket rules, it goes 1-1, 2-2, 3-3, 4-4. So 1-1 is going to be Nikki and Bobby, assuming Bobby wins this match. If he loses, though, he goes to the loser's bracket, and Nikki and Bobby likely may not be seeing each other in competition for some time, unless Nikki loses his next encounter.
Now, something I also want to know is if...
beautiful power slam.
Yes, that was beautiful. If Acharki loses here, does he face his tag team partner?
Silverstone. Now, if that... Yes. According to bracket rules, yes, he would be. Good point. That is actually very interesting because these brackets are not predetermined. They were not seeded. They were randomly drawn by myself live in front of a camera. Good counter by Acharki. And so the bracket drawing is 100% impartial. That's just how everything was laid out.
Well, freaking weird coincidence. I'm now sort of hoping Bobby wins this. I want to see those two matches.
I do too. Ooh, lock up.
Good knee lift there. Counter from Acharki, body punch, and then an earth clip kick. Taking a page from Nikki's book, but nothing after that. Thankfully, Acharki does get out of it into a sweet-looking neck breaker. Bobby on top now.
Bobby with that single leg.
Yes. Right now, it really is... I mean, both these wrestlers are very healthy. It's just a bat... Oh, Jesus Christ! Headbutt to the groin!
If I was reffing this match, I would seriously consider disqualifying Bobby there.
No kidding. I think there might be a little bit of collusion going on here between the referee and Bobby. Only time will tell. Great clothesline there.
Ryback-esque. Just winning away. Cover.
You're not going to get a pin that early.
Not at all. Bionic elbow. stomping a mud hole. Yes, Bobby right in here is definitely looking to take this match and take it quick.
Yeah, no kidding. I mean, like, that smarmy grin he made during his entrance, it's well deserved. But now, looks like he's making a comeback.
He goes for the pin.
Ooh, very quick. Wow. Just
not
a
going
one
down
count.
That easy.
Not
it seems
all.
Like it seems like Sharky might be trying to get some going, and no dice.
Arm ringer.
I think they kissed for like a second.
Ugh.
Bobby looking to discombobulate there by turning him around, but doesn't do anything as a Sharky counters, but Bobby counters back into a Russian leg sweep.
It seems like Bobby wants to forget about that cover.
But Bobby wants to get a quick pin here so he's nice and fresh for the rest of the tournament.
Exactly.
From the looks of things, it seems like he won't have much issue doing that. He's just... throughout the most of this, he's just been laying waste.
Yeah, this is definitely not going to be a clean... Whoa, no, that's a Texas jab combination right there. That is one of Bobby's signatures. That is absolutely huge.
It's almost unfair. Cover.
Absolutely, cover here. Hooks the leg. Oh, not good enough. Oh, by the way, James, do you have the move list?
Yes, I'm bringing that up now.
Good. Because I also do want to discuss some of the moves. Now, Bobby, as I learned recently, well, he used to use the flurry of blows as his finisher, which you saw in the previous tournament. I changed it because I recently found out that he's now going to college in the same university. Oh, wait, no, I'll stop. I'll stop here because Acharki's using the elbow of disdain. Elbow of disdain from Acharki that just might be enough. No.
That would never bring down Bobby.
I don't think so.
In a different match where things went slightly different, maybe, but not in this match at the moment.
Yeah, certainly not. But Bobby went to the same university as one Stone Cold Steve Austin, Spine Buster! And so I had to give him as his finisher the stunner. I had to. But he's not going for the stunner. Instead, he's doing a deadlift German suplex. That's finisher number two. He's doing a deadlift German suplex right into the bridge pin. It's not good enough.
It seemed like Acharki's foot was almost close to the rope break, but doesn't matter. He was able to kick it. Now Bobby just working the legs now.
All right, so... Acharki looks to be the current loser of the match. James, what do you think Acharki needs to do to get out of this hole?
He needs to get his head turned slightly and then either slide his arm in, counter it, or do what he's doing, get up and hammer away.
I absolutely love how literal you took what I asked.
It seems like,
I'm a very literal person.
It seems like maybe Bobby may not be as fast, so what Acharki pretty much needs to do is use that speed to his advantage, because it seems like he's the quicker person in this, but cover.
Yeah, right now I think Acharki he needs to land a finisher or some other big move to really put Bobby down. It just hasn't happened yet, though. Bobby's been all over him. Knee lift, though, from Acharki might get things rolling. No, instead he just goes for a pin. He thinks that's enough. I think the logic between those early pins is Acharki is trying to humiliate Bobby. Maybe he can catch Bobby off guard for just a moment. No, wait, he's going for the blue thunder bomb! That
straight
is
into the pin.
Yes, that is one of his finishers. It's still not good enough.
Another thing he could do is take this outside. Use the steps. Use the ring post.
No kidding. You have 10 valuable ref counts, because they're not seconds, they're ref counts. They're certainly longer than a second. To get, oh, no, wait. Bobby another refuses Texas to jab. Do that. Instead, he does a Texas jab combination. Numero dos, and he busts.
A Sharky is gushing.
He
oh
just
my gosh.
Busted a Sharky open, and he thinks that might be enough. You know what? I think that's enough, too. There's a cover. Hooks the leg. Ref counts.
No.
Two.
I thought that may as well be a knockout, but a Sharky's staying in this one. Just before he can go for the stunner.
Yeah, that is a good catch, actually. He was going for the chest kick that goes to the stunner, but a Sharky showboating a little bit, and we know that means one thing.
Comeback.
Scoop slam.
He got it.
And immediately right into the elbow of disdain, not wasting any time.
This is a smart thing to do. Just go on him, get on him, and get that pin.
Absolutely, that's what Bobby's been... No, it's still not good enough! I honestly thought that was it. Holy crap. Ooh, wow, that was a nasty haymaker. But he goes for a Blue Thunder Bomb!
Number two in this match.
One. Number two, that should be it right there. No!
No!
Oh my goodness.
What the hell is it gonna take? I cannot believe this. Irish whip into the corner, and a Sharky, I think the blood is disorienting. He's not going in right away, and Bobby takes the time to get out of it. And he's definitely oriented enough for a counter.
And looks like he's going for the stunner.
Yes, he is setting up for the stunner. Can he land it, though? That's the important part!
Oh!
Stone!
He's a bit close. There we go. He's moving him away from those ropes to avoid that rope break.
Absolutely brilliant right there from Bobby. What
no.
the fuck?
What?
Acharki is determined to win this thing.
What the actual fuck is happening? People don't kick out of the stunner. That's not... You don't kick out of the stunner.
Acharki does, though. I mean, this is his third match, yeah? He's probably not looking to go on another, like, losing streak.
This is actually the second match in the bracket, and now Bobby looks to rally. He might be able to get it, but it is a little hard for him to get it because it is in the corner, but he gets it regardless. He is up for the challenge, and now he looks to rally. Sharky, though, not giving up, and that is Texas Jab combination numero tres!
Putting on a boxing clinic.
Absolutely.
Sharky needs to be, like, knocked out at this point. Cover. No!
What?
No dice.
This could... The resilience of these two men. The heart of these two competitors to not kick out. Whoa, good spacing from Acharki to avoid the kick.
The stunner again.
Brilliant dodge. He just cheated death.
That's standing Kimura lock, I believe. I'm not 100% sure on that. No, wait, that's a hammer lock. That's what that is.
There you go.
There we go.
Finally!
And as I said, this match may... The deciding factor may be going outside.
Yeah, especially this late. Early on in the match, it's just kind of a tool to get an early lead. Now you are correct.
Perhaps Acharki needs to take advantage of the ring post. Give Bobby a taste of his own medicine.
Or maybe he just thinks the outside mat is harder than the ring. Which I don't think is correct.
As a referee, I haven't seen the WWE's mats, but the outside ground is a lot harder than in the ring, no matter how much padding you put on.
Oh, fair enough, because it doesn't have springs underneath. You're right. Okay. And good Falcon Arrow. Suplex Falcon Arrow.
That's gotta be it.
Pulls him away. And no, it is not it, because now he's going for a third elbow of disdain! A third! Kubito Akiet!
Two! No!
No!
This, it is what the match that never ends. It just goes on and on, my friends.
That one man.
Snap suplex.
The corrupted.
Oh, and now it's Sharky's looking for a third Blue Thunder Bomb. That's gotta be it if he hits this.
He's calling
it. What?
And
no! He just stole the Stone Cold Stunner! Are you kidding me?
He busted him too.
He's
one,
gonna win
two,
off of this!
Three! A Sharky got it!
A Sharky just stole the Stone Cold Stunner and won!
He took his finisher and used it against Bobby.
Bobby is going to be pissed. And I think he's going to take it out on a Sharky's partner.
I cannot believe this. I have no words for what I just witnessed. We're watching the replays right now, but I want to get to the one that really matters, okay? That was the most despicable thing I've ever seen in my life.
Well, we got the job done. And in the end, that's pretty much all that matters in a tournament like this.
Oh, fuck.
Watch this. He takes the stunner. And he gushes Bobby open with it, too. That is absolutely insane.
The thing I want to know is, do you guys think this is match of the night so far? So far,
here
it's
is
match
your
of the night,
winner,
but...
Acharky!
I would have to say that was incredible. Acharky really did have to dig deep down to the point of stealing his opponent's finisher, but regardless, Acharky moves on and Bobby goes to the loser's bracket. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. That is insane to me. I can't believe he just did that.
And James, that may be match like of the evening so far, but we still got some ways to go.
That was so stupid. Holy crap. So
I think...
Three jabs, one stunner. Wasn't enough to keep Acharky down.
That was so ridiculous.
Good lord.
That was
so
ridiculous.
And what it took to keep Bobby down was three elbows of disdain, two blue thunderbombs, and his own move.
Wow. Regardless,
so
though...
funny now that you think about it.
That was an incredible match. Incredible showing from both these men. Geeky Steven, now I'm going to have to bid adieu to you. But rest assured, during one of the other parts, we will hear from him again. Have a good night, bud.
All right, thanks for having me. It's real fun.
You sound out of breath. And now he hung up.
Goodbye, right. Geeky Steve.
So James will stay on for the next match. Silverstone is here to commentate the next two. Silver, how you doing, buddy?
Doing pretty well. It's been a crazy tournament so far, and we've only been like two matches in.
See, I told you guys that I fine-tuned this game to a polished sheen for AI versus AI matches, and I don't think I was lying.
Oh no.
I spent so much time fiddling those slider bars to make sure everything was perfect, and I think I got it.
I think you did get it.
Oh yeah. Some people just do this kind of stuff and just hit play. You've got this down to a fine sheen.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you very much. Oh, 100 hours, man. Over 100 hours. I don't know if you heard that part, James, but yeah, a lot. A lot of time went into this. All right. So, you two. Match number three, which is Steven AD versus Kirk Davis. So, are you guys all set on that end? Or do you need a few seconds?
I am ready.
Set.
Okay. So, now we are going to start match number three, as I just said. Three, two, one, go.
Alrighty.
Steven. Stephen A.D. versus Kirk Davis traveling back in time to fight at SummerSlam 91.
It was a good year. I was born that year.
Oklahoma City. And here we go.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from Columbus, Ohio, weighing in at 212 pounds, Stephen A.D.
Stephen A.D.'s character model is a little special, because with all of the other participants, I had to create their characters by kind of asking them, like, what do you want them to look like? What's your skin color, your hair color? What attire do you want? What do you want your finishers and signatures? What type of wrestler? What entrance? See, Stephen has the game for PC, and he can run it well, just like I can. So he created his own character in his own game, and he is the only one to have done so.
Amazing. You can definitely tell that it's very, very fine-tuned to his characteristics.
100%. He is arguably the most detailed character in the game. Because I spent 100 hours making the tournament, he spent 100 hours making his character.
And his opponent, from Westbrook, Maine, weighing in at 225 pounds, Kirk Davis!
Kirk Davis was on the History of WCW episode. I've been wanting to have him on for a while, but he's a bit hard to get because he's a school teacher. But this is his character. This is another one of those characters where instead of having, like, specific choices, we just picked shit and went with it. So, we put some douchey yellow flannel on him, put him in a pair of jorts, and slapped a pair of sunglasses and Beats headphones on his head and called it a day.
He looks like what a teacher should look like when he's not in school.
Yeah.
Actually, he kind of does. I never even thought
like about that. Like, on his off day, like, I see him in the supermarket, like, hey, Mr. Davis.
Also, Kirk Davis is his real name, and yes, he is named after that franchise. Legit.
Wow.
Now, teachers coming into the wrestling ring isn't a new thing. We've had Matt Stryker. We've had, what's his name? The genius.
Lanny Poffo. Lanny Poffo.
Yes, that's him. And some of them have done well.
Yeah, Matt Stryker, though, is better at calling the action than actually doing the action. So props to him for finding his niche and running with it.
Yeah. Indeed.
Locking up real quick by the ropes.
The slowest ref in history.
Gotta break them up, but Steven gets a shot in.
100% disrespect right there from Steven, but there's another lockup. And again, forcing to the ropes. And for some strange reason, during these lockups, the ref has to get in perfect condition before calling to separate the fuckers. Ooh, and Kirk strikes back.
And Kirk with a shot of his own.
Alright, now we finally get a proper lockup here. So, Silver, who do you think is going to win and why?
I mean, I feel like with Stephen A.D.'s characteristics and the fact that he fine-tuned his character to himself, I feel like he may have a distinct advantage, you know, picking the moves that would be like something that would
Well, I have to let you know, when it comes to moves and when it comes to stats, I
really?
Did all of that.
Oh.
I had to in order for balancing reasons. It's actually one of the reasons why I changed Bobby's finisher, because running preliminary tests, I noticed that Bobby's finisher setup was so slow that even while he was setting up for his finisher, while he was setting it up, certain wrestlers, once they got back up and got groggy, would actually be able to grab him out of it. So I had to change it.
Even with a great reversal and set of moves there.
So, James, who do you think is going to win and why?
These two are two unknowns, correct?
These are two brand newcomers to the tournament. They have not fought in the tournament. They fought in the Gold Rush tournament. But unfortunately, those matches are now non-canon due to the fact that I cannot broadcast them live. Ooh, good heel kick. So, yeah, James, just judging from what you've seen so far, who do you think is
going
to win?
I'm going to have to agree with Silverstone. AD is looking good so far, but that doesn't mean he's going to win, like in the last match.
Ooh, and Kirk just no-sells. Well, Kirk just no-sold the fuck out of that soccer kick.
Ooh.
So.
And then gave a kick of his own.
No kidding. I think Kirk allowed AD to have his fun, and now Kirk's going in for the kill.
Gonna overwhelm him with his strength. Working the leg there. Brings him back up. Puts him back down.
Right now, of course.
Transition.
The hammerlock.
All right, right now, oh, Jesus, we can't stop talking over each other. Ah!
We have such good synergy.
It's wonderful.
Wonderful.
That hammerlock's been on a long time.
Yeah,
and that's
what I heard. Here's the thing about Steven, though. Steven, I don't think it's a good strategy for Kirk to work the arm. Steven
Wait,
doesn't need them.
For a pin.
Oh, immediate
one.
Pin right there. No.
One count.
See, Steven's main weapons are his legs. Right? See, right there. Lots of kicks, lots of striking, lots of movement. If Kirk really wants to make a dent, he needs to target the legs. Oh, this may have been a huge mistake from Steven. Yes, it was, as Kirk immediately brings him down.
Picks him up, top rope. Body drop. Up. Brings him into the corner. And...
Up top, very quick. Steven's still fresh here. What's he looking for?
Whoa.
Spider suplex, holy crap.
And?
Just a splash.
Just a splash, very simple right there. Springboard fist!
He missed.
Did he miss?
He totally missed, if only barely. Either that or he didn't hit his hand on Kirk's head like he wanted to, but hit his head on Kirk's chest, doing damage to both of them instead of just one.
Kirk beats the leg. And that was beating him down.
Oh. Kirk, wow. Trying to get in the head of Steven AD.
Steven fires back another kick. Into the ropes.
Ooh, nasty clothesline. There's some stomps from Steven AD. Again, trying to keep Kirk in check. He's letting him know that he is the boss. So you may as well just... Wait, there's a Samoan Blitz!
Whoa! What a flurry of strikes.
That is a Samoan Blitz. That's one of Steven's signatures. Cover hooks the leg. Not good enough.
But man, did you see how fast that went out? Like, I was scared for a second. Even again. Oh. Kirk whipped out of it. And... reverse leg sweep.
Fantastic.
Looking for options. Going back up to his...
This might be... It is! It's the moonsault!
Moonstomp!
Moonsault stomp?
Moonstomp! It's a moonsault crossed with a coup de grace! And still Kirk kicks out of it!
Even cannot believe it.
Not many people can.
Seriously. Moonsaults are a staple in almost every wrestler's movesets because it's devastating. Finn Balor uses the coup de grace because, well, it's fucking ridiculously devastating. You combine the two together and yet Kirk still kicks out of it? Insanity. Regardless, though, Steven AD is well ahead in this match. Kirk hasn't been able to get any major offense in quite some time.
Yeah, it's been very, very, very much in Steven's favor. Oh, wait, dirty pin! Using the ropes as leverage. And Kirk fights out of it.
Yeah, now we're starting to see the wear and tear. Did you see Steven go right to the knee immediately?
Immediately, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, Kirk hits him off.
Kirk countered. This might be the opening. No! Steven,
nope.
Very quick still.
Puts him back down.
Headlock. There are a lot of ways to get out of this move, one of which is just rolling over and getting a pin, forcing them to break.
No, instead, Steven just releases the hold, but Kirk sees an opening and starts elbowing him to the face.
Elbows. Wait,
what is happening? Is Kirk seriously trying to appeal to the ref? That's not going to work, dude!
What was that even?
Slice bread!
See, it's funny, you call it the sliced bread, and I really think you're correct, but in the game, the sliced bread is straight up and down and not not horizontal springboards like that. Mm. So I honestly have no idea if you're correct.
It's more...
I think that's more
like a bulldog,
we'll just call
actually.
It a fairy root.
Okay, yes. Fair enough. Sliced bread. We'll do them both ways. But Kirk keeps countering, but he just can't get any kind of momentum. Hurricanrana from Steven A.D.
Wait. Oh.
Another runner into a pin.
Unbelievable.
One, two.
Oh, wait, and Kirk immediately. Whoa. Oh. Steven was underneath the ropes. That was brilliant strategy, though, from Kirk.
Here comes Kirk.
Back body drop.
And
what's he thinking?
Oh, right. Oh, this is it. This is his finisher. It's called the TKO.
Whoa.
It is a fireman's carry cutter.
He's going to pin him. There he is.
I think Steven just died.
Two.
Oh. Never mind. He's alive. We're good. Keep beating him up.
Kirk, of course, being very, very angry that he gets out of the TKO. But, nope, he's signaling for him to go to sleep.
He's actually signaling for a rally. For some strange reason, he uses the GTS chant to do that. I don't know why, because he does not have the go to sleep. In fact, another wrestler in the tournament has the go to sleep. Spoilers for the rest of the tournament. And there's an Irish curse backbreaker!
Irish curse backbreaker.
Straight into his pin, in a pin.
Even AD kicks out. And again, Kirk is just on his knees wondering what he has to do to put away Steven AD. Again.
And now Kirk is looking. He is looking for the other finisher in his arsenal, the gunshot!
Ooh.
That running knee. I think
pins
it's
him
it.
Again. One. Two.
What?
Wait,
no.
What? So guys, gentlemen, Silver, James.
Yeah.
Steven just got hit with two different finishers in succession within 2.5 minutes. Why is he still alive?
I'm just going to go with the old dominant factor of instinct. I don't know.
I want to say, but I think Kirk, in just the span of less than 3 minutes, has established dominance in this match.
I think you may call it instinct, but like, Steven AD just like has like a natural will to just keep the fight going. Like he has to like keep himself alive. Like he's been dominant in the beginning, but now it's turned against him. But he still has a bit left in the tank. You know, he's trying to use that to his best advantage.
He doesn't want to go down to that loser's bracket.
Oh wait a minute! The Hurricane Rana. Steven up to now.
I think they both have wear and tear. It's just they're both not wanting to drop down to that loser's bracket.
Whoa!
Wow, that could be it.
Grab DDT.
But that's a very weak pin. But it's enough! And
like I said,
the teacher gets an F for this class in wrestling?
Dismissed.
Unbelievable. Leg trap DDT from Steven.
I told you, he had like a bit left in the tank and he used it for that leg trap DDT. So that was definitely the last gas and it worked for him.
Worked very well.
If that didn't work, I think it was over for him. But now we've got our second match, the starts of our second match in the losers and winners brackets set up.
And that right there is a leg trap DDT, his second finisher. And that right there was enough. Even with the weak pin, it was still good enough to secure Steven as the winner. And he moves on.
Here is your winner, Steven A.D.
Nitty moves on, and Kirk falls to the loser's bracket.
Well, all done.
Also note, he didn't kick out even after the free count. He was still out.
Yeah.
Oh. A DT really put him out.
Yeah, dude. It was crazy. Absolutely nuts. Okay, so, James, because the next match is your match, I'm going to have to say...
I must bid you all adieu.
Yep. And I know you have that thing to go to, so in case you can't come in later, I'm going to say goodbye and have a good day.
Well, if you'll have me back, I should be able to join, depending on how long the other matches are, because it's I don't have to be anywhere until 2. That's when other things start happening.
Mysterious other thing.
Because as all indie feds, I'm part of the ring crew.
Yep, exactly.
Yes, so I will see you all later, and I hope I beat Toon again.
Oh,
we'll have to see. Okay, so we're going to see... anyway, James, thank you so much for joining us.
It has been a pleasure.
Take care.
Okay, so we're going to see if there's anybody else that is available. Because if not, I'm actually going to break my rule. Because I would like to hear Toon's reaction in case he wins. I'd also like to hear his reaction if he loses, because he was so salty last time. He was not happy. Not even for a minute. And I want to hear the salt. I'd also like to hear his victory chants. Either way, it's gonna happen. But if nobody else is available, because I know Voice was supposed to come in, Voice of Reason, but he's not feeling well. Nelson Demifer, if you are out there and you have the matches, get in the call, dude. All right. So, if you guys want to take a bathroom break, go ahead and do that now.
Hello?
Oh, Nelson. Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Nelson Demifer. All right. So, how you doing, man?
Doing all right so far. Glad I got in time.
Good. Yes, great. All right. So, just for future reference, so you can get it started now, we're on match 4, Toon Critic versus James the Squirrel Theorist.
Ooh.
All right. So, Nelson, why don't you introduce yourself?
What do I say? This is Nelson Demifer. I've been, I'm watching you guys for a long time, watching the Haymakers. I'm definitely a long time wrestling fan. Glad I got to be in this.
Well, you're welcome in advance. Fun fact for the chat, Nelson is your viewer representative. So if you don't know who to cheer for him. He is representing you guys.
Yeah. So win or lose, I'm the person you gotta blame.
Yes. Correct. All right. So, glad to have you here. I noticed your dedication because you've been with you've been listening to the Haymakers and watching us since the beginning. You've always been here. So I just wanted to reward you by giving you a shot in the tournament, and I hope things go well for you.
Yeah, we'll see when my turn comes up.
All right, so do you have everything set up, Nelson? Silver?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
I do.
All right, so the next match, a rivalry match, the very first rivalry match in Haymakers history. Silverstone, Nelson, 3, 2, 1, go.
All righty. This is going to be pretty interesting.
100%. Toon Critic versus James the Squirrel Theorist. These two have wanted to get Oh, they've wanted to get at each other for a long time, and they've had to wait, but now is finally their chance.
Comes Tim.
Doesn't Toon's coat look much better now?
Oh yeah, it does.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from Chicago, Illinois, representing the Saints of Smart, weighing in at 250 pounds, Toon Critic!
Nelson, please turn up the mic gain on your mic. You need to be a little bit louder.
Toon's promo a few days ago was pretty raw, if I can say so myself.
100%. He called. Here's the thing. Gabriel kind of just hyped himself up for the most part. Silver, you called out Gabe directly. Toon called out Gabe and Squirrel Theorist, and Nikki hyped himself up. I wanted to tape a promo, but every time I recorded, it was complete, absolute 100% garbage, so I never uploaded one. But here comes his opponent.
And his opponent, from Melbourne, Australia, weighing in at 187 pounds, James the Squirrel Theorist.
You gotta wonder how long Toon's been wanting this rematch.
He's been wanting it since March 19th. I streamed the first tournament live on St. Patrick's Day last year, or this year, I should say. And the canonical date is March 19th because that's when the stream archive was uploaded to YouTube. So he has wanted it for almost exactly 6 months. Half a year.
Half a year in the making. And now Beast 2 is going to go at it in the ring.
And a half year period that he lost two matches straight.
Correct. Toon is winless both in tournament and exhibition. He has not won at all. So we're going to have to see if he can finally pull it off and redeem himself against...
I think he just needs one win just to redeem himself.
He really does.
Right into the lockup.
So, Nelson, you said that Toon needs one win. If he doesn't win here, what do you think would be enough to redeem himself?
Okay, if he can't win here, he has to at least put up a good fight. It has to be, I'd say, clean, or at least clean enough so that it doesn't look like it's a dirty loss.
I agree. If Toon can't really like hack it here, he's gonna have like an insane loser's run using the energy from this kind of from the possible loss. But, like, let's not count him out yet. So, like, we never know what Toon can bring here.
Well,
yeah, it just Toon, doesn't look like a good start for him either, right here.
Not at all. James trying to get Toon out of the ring, succeeding.
And succeeds.
And that is a good start right there from James. As he said in the last match, bring your opponent to the outside of the ring. There are tools there. Go ahead and use them.
He's using them to his fullest advantage.
Working those knees.
Working the knees. That's a base for lifting, and that's what Toon wants. He is one of the heaviest opponents in the tournament, so you know he can lift a lot of weight. Ooh, great counter right there all of a sudden from Toon, but no good. Front drop kick. From James the Squirrel Theorist lets him know, hey, you're winless in the tournament, man. You're done.
Toon still fights out of it. Misses the stomp right there, but turned over.
Good countering.
And then gets another counter.
There's another counter there again. Both of these people trying to establish early dominance. Spine buster.
Spine buster from Toon.
Hit your knees.
And yes, everybody, audience, Nelson, Silver, I will always call a spine buster by saying it like that.
That
Don't
body drop.
Expect me to change.
No problem.
Body drop in.
It's funny too, like if I'm watching an wow, okay, James goes to the top. It's weight, whoa!
Wait, he jabs him from the top rope.
Oh my god, he's going into a flying headbutt this early?
Whoa.
That's one of his signatures.
Not only did he go for the flying headbutt, he made sure he hit the flying headbutt.
No, it is not one of his signatures. I was scared there for a second, actually. That is not.
Working the back and neck.
Yes.
But the rope break.
Yep, Toon rolls out of the way now. Still no. James still establishing an early lead. And, oh, James right there tried to get him out. Instead changes his mind. Assisted neck break.
Off the ring.
Neck breaker off the rope. Off the ropes. The extra leverage there is going to really hurt.
Real close to the ring. Close to the ropes.
Toon kicked out at one.
Toon, I think, wanted to prove a point. I don't think he wanted to break the ropes and... Well, Toon gets out of that right there. Well done.
You said Toon wants to prove a point. I think the only point he's proven that it's going to be deja vu all over again.
I think so. James has been on top for most of this match.
Jumped him from the elbow.
There's an elbow again, but I do think Toon can open him up.
Working the knees again.
And shoulder tackle.
Shoulder tackle it is.
And the kick to the head.
Oh.
Scoop slam. Or not a scoop slam. I keep confusing the power slam and the scoop slam. Regardless, Toon kicks out. Nelson, you're about, like, a little bit ahead of us. Just slightly. Ever so slightly.
All right. Drops him down. Again, to the knees.
Yes, James. Oh, right to the groin. Oh, my goodness. I think the ref may have thought it was an abdominal shot. James bringing him over to the ropes. What's he planning here? Oh, just a simple Irish whip. Faking us all out. Great forearm there, though.
And this...
Here comes Toon.
Yep, there's Toon. He found an opening. He's being patient here, and that's a good thing. He needs to be patient.
Yes, but the difference between being patient and being a bit lazy about it. And Toon really needs to go. He needs to get it. Now he has an opening, he really needs to go for it.
All right. Flips him.
Oh! Wow!
Gorilla press.
Gorilla press flapjack, and Toon thought that was enough. I didn't think so, and neither did James as he kicks out. Soccer ball kick.
It's a good shot.
Super kick! There's super kick from Toon! And no, he immediately... Whoa! Are you serious? Super kick into a giant swing without even hesitating.
Wow.
Holy... That is what I was talking about by patience.
Okay, Toon was looking... I've been waiting for Toon to see what Toon was going to do to redeem himself. I think this is his way of redeeming himself.
In a matter of moments.
He figured something out right there. He learned. He knows that he can go from a super kick into a giant swing, but regardless, James off the top rope, elbow to the head. And now James, that was important right there, actually. It didn't seem like much, but James was actually setting up for the running knee, one of his signatures. But I don't think Toon was in the proper position, and now Toon is going to go for a pinfall, unsuccessful, as James the Squirrel Theorist kicks out.
Toon again, in a matter of moments, like, the entire landscape of the match is in his step, and now he's just stomping him.
Toon is showing all that. Toon is showing 6 months of aggression, 6 months of patience, 6 months of anger. But can he? But will he run out of steam from it?
Locking him up here. James trying to fight out of it. Yep. Strikes to the midsection.
Oh, great elbow right there. Toon counters though. Body back. Punch.
Turns him around. Toon looking for.
Nasty.
Drags him to the center of the ring. James kicked out of two.
So, Silver, what is the game plan now for James to get back in this match?
For James to get back in the match, he's going to have to really, like, cut off the source of Toon's, like, rampant, like, destruction here. Like, Toon has been able to, like, really, like, be patient here. And, like, in using those kind of, like, lulls in between, Toon was able to, like, really fire back. So, I think it's prime time for James to, like, use that kind of, like, same idea. Also, to use his own strategy, put him on the outside, and wreck him from there. Oh, misses there from Tune.
I don't think at this point James can be patient.
Whoa! Wow! What a lariat there from Tune!
Good lord. That's flying.
James knows that Tune is angry, and Tune knows he
that
can't.
That anger! Look at Tune!
He cannot let go. He cannot stop. The minute Tune Critic stops, James can come in and take it over. And that is not what he wants.
Oh wow, okay. James found an opening, but Tune immediately does that, gets him back in for a running clothesline.
Ugh. Now Tune.
Now it is Tune looking for it, but there's a kip up from James. I think James is gonna be looking to rally. He's not in a good position for it though. James does not take advantage, and that is bigger than you think it is!
Hangs him up on the ropes. But that, go for the pin.
Going for a pin, he thinks that's enough. That's huge, though. He was looking to rally, and he never got it successfully. Tune hung himself on the ropes, and James had to do that to force him off. That is big. Right down to the ground there.
Ooh.
Working the knee.
It looks like now Tune's working the knee.
Tune is using that ruthless aggression. You know.
Suplex. Ooh, wow! Bridging German suplex right there from Tune! No!
He's crazy. Go through the ropes, but still was able to, Oh, DDT!
Brilliant DDT right there.
Ridiculous. There's a club right there from Tune. Oh, and there's James with an opening.
Russian leg sweep.
He's pulling into the middle.
Into the middle. James trying to go for a pin? He is.
Yeah. Lull Tune into a false sense of security, but not good enough.
I think that pin was too early. Going for the pin was too early. He should have went for something off the ropes.
Oh, too early and too desperate. Wait. Another DDT. Picks him back up again. Soon thinking.
I'm not sure, but whatever it is, I don't think James is going to like it. Oh, and another running clothesline.
Nope, definitely didn't like that.
Like, I'm not sure you know this, but Tune is like, you know, whenever he's like whipping him, he's like walking to him. Like,
fuck! Ref! Okay, Tune risked a lot with that. He risked a DQ.
Did.
Especially since now he's on top. It's like, why bother?
I think all that aggression that we all talked about is starting to get to him. Risking the false disqualification when he's definitely got the hang of his match. Tune needs to actually calm a little, just calm down just a little.
No, Tune thinks that's enough though with a pin. One, two, no.
Oh,
it's just not enough.
It's simple. Tune needs to stop playing with his food and just go for it. The GTS or the XKO or whatever he calls it. Is this it? Whoa! I called it! I totally called it! GTS connecting! GTS connecting! I think that might be what Tune needs! One, two, three!
That is it! The XKO Aki does it!
Tune Critic, you just got a redemption.
Tune Critic, months and months of frustration. All unleashed in that simple XKO. Tune called it in his promo, and he made sure that the crowd here would not be going home without a Tune victory.
He needed this victory. He had six months to get everything. He had 6 months to watch James, and it showed here. But even though Tune didn't start this match easy, he definitely finished it hard.
What an unbelievable way to start Tune's second tournament run with a win, not a loss. His first win right there. That is the GTS or the XKO or whatever you want to call it.
And like I said, he needed a clean win, and this is his clean win.
Tune was correct. The facts are true. One XKO did the job.
Tune Critic.
As such, Tune Critic now moves to the second round of the winner's bracket, and James goes to the loser's bracket. Completely opposite of what happened last time. I cannot believe it. Props to tune.
I know if he, I know he must feel good that he's not going home with the first loss.
Unreal. I cannot believe what I just saw. Congrats to Toon. Finally, he wins a match and in epic, epic fashion. So, with that, Silver, I'm going to have to say goodbye to you. I hope you enjoyed being on the stream.
Oh, yeah, I highly enjoyed it.
Excellent. Well, hopefully we'll see you again in part two, right?
Yes, indeed. You guys will see me.
All right, very good. Take care, bud.
Take care, everyone.
All right, so Nelson, you're going to stay in, and I'm going to bring in Toon. Going to bring him back. And Toon's going to come in, and it's going to be hilarious.
Let's just brace ourselves.
I'm sorry? Oh, brace ourselves, yeah. Okay, Toon, shut up, shut your fucking hole. Hold on. Post-match interview here. Post-match interview, 1 second. We have to do this properly, okay? Hold on.
Boy.
Okay? Toon, how do you feel?
Oh, man. It's about waiting. It's all about the fucking payoff. I've been winless this entire time, but I just had to do a little thing that Seth Rollins taught me that's redesign, rebuild, and win. And I did that. I made sure I came back with a move that can finish anything. All it takes is one XKO, and it did. One was all it took. Busted him open. I am sending his ass to the loser bracket.
So, Toon, what color are your walls right now?
Oh, man. I can't even tell anymore. I think you could fucking know why.
That's not the answer I was expecting, but okay.
I don't think we're going to get a better answer than that.
No. Okay, so match five, guys, now. Match five. Let me know when you got it ready.
Oh, my God. I was on the edge of, like, my seat, and I just jumped up when that happened. I'm just like, oh, finally. Yeah. Oh, man.
So, okay, one final question. Toon, if you were to lose the next two matches, would you be salty?
I wouldn't fucking care.
All right, time to rig the brackets. Care. Time to rig the brackets.
Oh, fuck off.
Okay,
no,
so...
No, listen, I'm just happy that I finally got some fucking redemption. Who am I going up against next? Fucking Steve? Hashtag believe in Steve? Oh, yeah. Man, he's... If he wipes the floor with me, you know, that's fine. fucking Steve, he was, like, powerhousing through the last match. I would not be surprised if he, like, walks through me, too, but, like, no,
we'll
I'm here.
We'll have to see, man, because you, in the later half of that, walked past James. Did James even get a single signature off? Like, I didn't even notice. He didn't get anything off.
I think he got, like, let me see that list. I think he got like one or two in, but I don't think he even hit a finisher.
No, he didn't. He didn't hit a single running knee or hammerlock DDT or Salida del Sol or Slingblade. You dominated him in the last half. And I don't think that will happen next time in the loser's bracket when he goes up against Kirk Davis. I think James is going to make sure that he hits Kirk with all of the Salida del Sols. He'll just imagine Kirk is you. Anyway.
No, man, we are 1-1. Whatever happens next, I'm going. I'm running straight for that gold. I don't care who I got to get through.
All right, so before we get to match five, I just want to update you guys real quick. Right now, this is what the bracket looks like. Nikki V has been victorious over Silverstone. Acharki defeated Bobby in nefarious fashion. Steven AD steamrolled Kirk Davis. And Toon Critic redeemed himself against James the Squirrel Theorist. This is what the bracket looks like now. We are halfway through the initial day one, night one of the Haymakers Tournament Spectacular. The next match, of course, is going to be Kalkos versus Geeky Steven. And I have a question. What's up?
How do we know you didn't rig what's going to happen?
Because you have to trust me?
Okay, all right. If you win, I'm going to be very suspicious.
Okay. Trust me, I didn't rig. I did one recording. That's why you could, even then, you could hear a sound glitch in Nikki and Silverstone's match. I left it in because one recording. As long as nothing royally fucked up, one recording, that's it.
All right.
We'll see.
And I'm just fucking with you. I trust you. But it'd be hilarious if, like, you win, everyone's questioning it, and I'll be the one in the corner saying, he rigged it!
See, you trust me, but what about everybody else?
I don't know.
Everyone else is supposed to start calling you botch.
Okay, so if you both have match 5 ready, set up, and ready to go, let's get this going. Okay, so one second, please. Okay, so match 5, Geeky Steven versus Kalkos. 3, 2, 1, go.
This should be interesting.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from Fort Wayne, Indiana, weighing in at 211 pounds, Geeky Steven.
Geeky Steven, of course, is a newcomer to the tournament. Pretty cocky, pretty brash, pretty arrogant, but I have done a lot of preliminary testing, and this guy means business.
Question.
Yep.
Did he have to go with the seat?
Sorry, say that again.
You have to go with that secret.
I cannot hear you. I apologize. Bring your mic up a little bit.
His costume. That looks like a good.
Oh, yes. Yes. And yes, Silver, he does use Austin's old entrance. I liked the theme. I presented it to Geeky, and he liked it too. But his opponent.
And his opponent, from Bidford, Maine, representing Vicious Delicious, weighing in at 261 pounds, Kalko.
It's all about the game and how you play it, all about controlling if you can take it.
Really? Really, Kalkos? Are you gonna bury everybody? See, now this just has me even more convinced. You somehow.
Hey, look.
You're being Triple H. Hey, everybody.
Look, you dense motherfucker. I created this tournament. I can choose my own entrance. Okay. I chose Triple H because I am the kingpin. I am the leader. I am the one that makes or breaks superstars in the ring.
The Jack the Old character up with steroids?
Yes.
Oh, Jesus.
I gotta say, though, I love that shot. I actually went, when I saw I previewed this entrance with my character, I actually went and previewed it with the rest of the custom characters. That shot right there, the close-up after spitting the water bottle, looks awesome on all of them. Legit, it's so well done. But to be honest, you want to know the real reason why I chose Triple H's entrance?
I'm curious.
I wanted to hear your reaction to it.
Oh, fuck you.
The match is underway. Kalkos wastes no time.
Jesus.
No time from Kalkos. Jesus, he is not
coming out swinging.
He is not going to fuck around with chain wrestling. He is going to make sure Geeky Steven knows who's boss with a throat chop. Holy shit, what is happening?
Geeky's the newcomer, and he's about to get a fucking lesson up in here. Imagine if Geeky is like, you know, a new dog showing up to, like, you know, the dog playground, and he's just chilling out, and then he starts getting cocky and shit. Out comes the big fucking dog, Calcos, to remind him, hey, bitch, this is my yard.
No fucking kidding. That was so fast. But thankfully, that was just initial, as now Geeky Steven looks to build some offense. But Calcos again says no.
I hope this doesn't become a squash match.
I think it just might be.
Oh, if that were the case, that'd be hilarious.
I will let you know right now, just spoilers for the rest of the tournament. That is another thing that I re-record for, because there are certain times, because the AI can be a little shifty. It happens rarely, but there are times where the match will have gone on for about 2.5 minutes and someone will get a pin either because the AI failed to kick out or because a rope break didn't work. I do not air those matches. Those matches are re-recorded because that is stupid.
Oh, okay, so if that's the case, you just re-record when you lose then. Okay, that makes
100,
sense.
100 fucking percent. I am going to win this belt, even if it means I have to reverse time and re-record matches. But wow, Geeky Steven denies Calcos his offense and goes for a swinging neckbreaker.
You heard it here first.
God damn it, Toon.
He will re-record and rewind time to make sure that he wins. Ladies and germs, everyone else in this tournament is going to have to fucking break their codes now to beat Calcos.
Ooh, and Calcos escapes the rope right there. Geeky Steven takes that time to try and taunt, but no dice.
Nope.
Not a good
Ooh,
idea.
Ooh, and then Geeky Steven performs a nope. And then Calcos performs a nope. It's nopes all over the place. And now it's Geeky Steven with another nope.
Oh man, this is going to be get in one sitting.
And there's a nope!
Reversals are now nopes. I love it.
Oh, and that's not a nope. No. Oof.
Jesus.
Now Calcos is done playing with his food. No. Geeky Steven's still healthy. Ooh, fireman's carry there from Geeky Steven. Airplane spin. Okay, Calcos decides to stop playing with his food, and then Acharki decides to start. But not Acharki, I apologize, Geeky Steven. See, here's the thing. Geeky Steven and Acharki have very similar move sets. There are differences, but they're very similar to me because they started with the same template. So I constantly refer to Geeky Steven as Acharki, and I apologize for that. But Geeky Steven now getting Irish whipped into the corner, and now Calcos very quickly looks to get him up to the top rope.
What's he gonna do here?
Uh-oh. This is a painful move. It makes me wonder, every time I see them do a back suplex off like the top rope, it makes me wonder, how bad is that? Like, who gets the worst out of that?
I don't know. I think it's
50-50. Whoever does it is gonna take some damage, but whoever gets done too takes a little bit more.
Yeah.
It all matters on. Ooh.
Also, I love how the chat is just having fun with our commentary.
Calco's put on a suspicious amount of muscle. I suspect steroids. And then he fails the drug test.
Yeah, they're comparing me to Brock Lesnar, which they really shouldn't, because Bobby's moveset is closer to Brock Lesnar's than mine. Mine is closer more to classic powerhouses, people like Bruno Sammartino, Arn Anderson, Kurt Angle, people
you look
that can
like
lift.
Fucking Rusev.
I do, and I think a lot of that has to do with my boots, which I actually forgot to change because I don't want that footwear anymore, but I keep forgetting to change it, so I think I'll do that for part two. New ring attire for part two. But Calcos Exploder Suplex in the corner. That is one of his signatures right there. Calcos getting in the first strike of the night, the first big move, and there's a cover. Hooks the leg. Is that enough? No.
Nope. So, Kalkos, your finishers are the Steiner Screwdriver and the Gore, correct?
That is correct. The Steiner Screwdriver, which is, I'm not going to explain it because, well, if you haven't seen it, you're gonna. And, or at least I hope you are. But first, before you see the Steiner Screwdriver, Gore! 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 Gore!
That's it.
Right through the DOP.
This is the move that got Rhino the SmackDown Tag Team titles. Cover here, hooks the leg.
Whoa.
Okay, this dog has a little bit more fight in him.
Also, I love how a lot of the chat are rooting for me, so that actually makes me feel really, really good about myself. Thank you guys very much. What the fuck? Torture rack? Holy shit, what is that?
I've never seen it done like that.
Torture rack.
But Geeky Steven still finds the resolve to get out, but Kalkos immediately says nope into a snapmare.
When I see a move like that, it reminds me when fucking Ezekiel Jackson did that, and it looks so weird and weak.
Oh, whoa, he's going for it! He's going for a finisher! The lukewarm hammer!
Oh! That could be it?
Maybe it is only lukewarm. It's not burning. Oh! Ooh, Kalkos kicks out. Maybe if he set fire to it and made it a burning hammer, it would have worked. But instead, it's just a lukewarm hammer. By the way, I'm not making fun of Geeky Steven when I say that. That is a burning hammer. But it's a safer variant of it, and I was initially going to call it the Burning Hammer, but then Brian Kendrick versus Kota Ibushi happened, so I can no longer call it a Burning Hammer. But here comes Geeky Steven looking to rally with a Warrior Drop and then a splash to the back!
Vintage Ultimate Warrior there.
Ooh, and a knee lift from Kalkos. And now Kalkos looks to rally. That right there would even it up.
Kalkos got back. Something. And he's just gonna stay. Oh, never mind. Come back. Here we go. Ooh! Pele kick.
Never seen one of those that are running for a rally.
Oh, wait! Another signature!
Oh, beautiful.
Single leg face buster right there from Kalkos. That is one of his signatures. He thinks it's enough here. There's the cover. Hooks the leg. No!
That's kind of like half a code breaker. I remember when Gregory Helms used to use that.
It kind of. It's a bit too much to be a code breaker, though, because a code breaker is basically a backstabber, but on the face. Whoa, this is the... No! Kalkos is going for the Steiner Screwdriver!
Oh, Jesus, I felt that in my neck.
How did you not feel that?
I'm sorry?
How did you not feel that?
I don't know!
That's
what?
It.
What? Oh.
And he kicks out!
Geeky Steven!
He's just doing that on instinct.
Geeky Steven right now is saying either I win or I die. That is what Geeky Steven is saying right now. He kicked out of a Gore and a Steiner Screwdriver. And now Kalkos looks for more, but Geeky Steven finds an opening into a flying standing senton!
He's doing this with a broken fucking...
And here it is! That's one of his signatures! It's the Neglected Elbows!
Cover.
And now Geeky Steven thinks it's enough. A finisher and a signature, but it is not! What the fuck is happening with this match?
How is Geeky still in this?
How is he still conscious?
I don't know, man. Kalko stumbles a little bit.
Oh, taking him up and
Great rebound suplex there.
I'm guessing that the Steiner Screwdriver is not allowed in the WWE.
Yeah, no. It is a pile driver. So, yeah, no.
A pile driver into a suplex into a pile driver. The only time I've seen it is in WCW. And even then, it's done like maybe 3 times.
And Geeky Steven looks to set it up. What? Kalkos! Whoa! Kalkos just countered his finisher! First one of the night! Whoa! Kalkos may have just stolen a victory off of that, and there's a single knee face buster! Whoa! So much is happening in this match. Holy shit! Geeky Stevens showing unbelievable resolve, kicking out of two of the most devastating finishers in wrestling history. Kalkos showing very quick timing and just pure reflexes by countering Geeky Stevens' finisher. But now look at them. Now look at them.
First to get up. Oh, what's he doing? He's got
it's
something.
It's almost even. With just those few moves, it's almost even.
Uh-oh. Oh, this is it.
Gore. This Gore. Is it. He, Gore.
Okay, there,
Gore.
There no
Gore.
Get up
Gore.
And it's over. It's got to be. Oh, my God. Like, nobody's getting up from that.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
I'm not surprised.
Three finishers.
They need to call 911 for you.
Three finishers, two variants, and two single knee facebusters is what it took for Kalkos to take Geeky Steven out. Kalkos was in fact looking to bury the competition, but that is certainly not happening today, as Geeky Steven says that he is not leaving without a fight.
Oh my God, if anything, Geeky showed a shit ton of resilience here. I gotta say, it's very impressive the fact that he lasted this long. But I thought it was over after that freaking screwdriver. But man, resilience is key here. But after like two gores and a screwdriver and facebusters all around,
Kalkos just went for the head multiple times. With each and every, and with all three of his finishes.
I want Geeky to compete in the next match with the neck brace.
I don't know if that's an option for a tire.
Here is your winner, Kalkos.
He just may need a neck brace for like the next 3 days, 3 weeks, however
probably
long it takes.
3 years, 30 years.
I don't know, man.
Because you do not take a Steiner screwdriver and get up from it immediately.
No.
It just doesn't happen.
Everyone's dropping like fucking Triple H buried things in the fucking chat.
I gotta see this. Oh, yes! The custom burial entrance. Thank you, Silverstone. That match was fun. That was a lot of fun. Oh, that was good. Good, clean fun. I liked it. Thank you, Geeky Steven, for that. But regardless, Geeky Steven goes to the loser's bracket, and Kalkos advances on winner's side. Give
I
me.
Think it's more appropriate to say Geeky goes to the loser's bracket and neck brace.
Yeah. Give me 1 second. I'm going to get some water.
I thought you were going to say, give me a fucking mic for a second. okay. So, for those who are just joining in now, I will be the one to give you up to speed what's going on. So, in the first match, we had Nikki go up against Silverstone, and Nikki won. We had. Following up with that, we had Bobby versus Acharki, and Acharki won that match. We had Steven AD versus Kirk, and Steven proved, once again, hashtag believe in Steve. And then you had me versus James the Squirrel Theorist, and I got some much-needed redemption on my part for that. And now, if you're just joining in, Kalkos took the fight to Geeky Steven and broke his fucking neck.
I think it's more than just broke his neck. I think he broke his neck at least twice.
Yeah.
Oh, no, no. Here's the thing. He broke his neck, but then broke it back into place, I think.
That's pretty funny.
And then decided, oh, let's ruin his stomach and gore him twice.
Yeah. Okay.
If Kalkos isn't unconscious, he's not breathing right now.
You mean Geeky?
Oh, yeah, Geeky. It was that painful. I'm messing up names. It was that painful.
Oh, man.
Oh.
All right, so Nelson, I'm going to say goodbye to you for now. Toon is going to stay here. But Nelson, I might bring you back in for another match down the line. We'll have to see what happens. But regardless, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you. Thank you for keeping me here. Now we'll keep watching.
Yeah, thank you absolutely. For your support, dude. We always look forward to seeing you in the comments.
100%, man. You're one of our... Here's the thing. You're a fan of us, but in a weird kind of way, we're a fan of you. So, don't worry
Thanks
about
for
it.
The compliment.
Have a good night.
You too.
That was fucking intense.
Yeah, dude, holy shit, that match was great. Props to Geeky Steven for bringing the fire.
Oh, yeah.
James, are you here?
Now, yes, James?
Now, James.
I only have one thing to say. Good GG. All right, GG. I'll be a good sport this time.
Now, we've got one of two options here between me and you. Either the rubber match, or we team up and take the belts. That's all I can see.
Oh, good. Plotline progression. Oh, I love the kayfabe. Yay!
I don't know, man. I'm just kind of used to doing things on my own, but we're going to have like a rudder match to at least even things out. That much I could say. Tag title? I don't know, maybe.
Well, we could obviously beat the current tag team champions.
Oh, yeah, we totally could, but...
Yeah. All right, so match number six, guys, the Battle of the Bizarre Ones. Do you guys have it loaded up?
Oh, yes.
I'm about to. Oh, now I understand what you mean by Bizarre Ones.
Ha-ha! Yep. Two of the weirdest characters that we have in the tournament are going to be fighting each other, which is interesting. I don't like it. I wish I could have separated them, but...
Oh, come on. This just makes this match more important.
In a way, kind of. I really don't know who to root for on this one. So, regardless, let me know when you guys are all set up.
Nikki's angry. He's like, fucking excuse me, you what, mate? I don't know.
Now we have to turn, just to rub it in.
We can at least challenge for the fucking Edgelord and the Squirrel, fucking...
By the way, guys in the stream, while they load everything up, you guys enjoying it so far? Sound off.
I'm pretty sure they are. This has been a blast.
This has been great. Thank you, James. Thank you, Toon. I appreciate it. Oh, my God. It's only going to get better, too, because... Oh, announcement! I should say this now while people are paying attention. I have a wheel.
You have a wheel. Are we playing Eric Bischoff's Raw Roulette? Are we playing Dario's Wheel of Doom?
Yes, we are. Starting in Part 2 and Part 3 of the Haymakers Tournament Spectacular, we will be adding match stipulations.
Hell yeah.
Yes, not all of them. I can say we can't have all of them because during the Gold Rush Tournament, we learned that a couple of the map stipulations are kind of garbage when it comes to AI versus AI matches.
That's my fault.
I already know which ones are not good for AI versus AI. Tables matches, ladder matches kind of suck, which is annoying as shit. I kind of wish I could do one without something to grab just for a pinfall.
We tried Hell in a Cell, but none of them fucking left the cell or used the cell.
Well, here's the thing about Hell in a Cell. They can, but Voice won that match so fucking quickly that they never got the chance.
Yeah.
I will explain what happened in that match when we get to Voices match, but regardless, the good match stipulations, no holds barred, extreme rules, Hell in a Cell, they will be here. Iron Man matches as well. In fact, the finale
submission
matches, no, because here's the thing. Nobody in the tournament has a submission move as a finisher because the AI does not tap. So until I can figure out how to make the AI tap, no submission moves, because you will never win with one. So, regardless, I know it's disappointing. I would have stacked myself with submission moves if that were the case. I would have put Nikki with a lot of submission moves. I probably would have put you, James, with a couple of submission moves, but I can't.
I had the Anaconda Vice for a while, I think.
Yep, they just don't tap. So until I can figure out how to make them tap, then no submission moves. But regardless, match number six, Junkachu versus Buck E. Dangerously. Are you two ready?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. 3, 2, 1, go.
This is gonna be interesting.
Very, very interesting.
I just hope we don't get a new dangerous alliance.
Also, Toon, how do you like Bobby being in the video now?
I'm fine with it.
Isn't it better than having to hope and pray you don't talk over him?
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from the 90s, weighing in at 193 pounds, Junkachu!
From the 90s? Really?
Yes.
Remind me next time I see him to super kick him.
This is Junkachu. Now, Junkachu is represented by... Hold on, I'm going to turn the volume down here. Is represented by Punk... he represents, sorry, Punk Gamer, who was in the SummerSlam cast and is added into the tournament. So, Junkachu is very, very weird. And this is definitely the biggest case of it just went there, don't ask questions.
And his opponent, from Honolulu, Hawaii, weighing in at 206 pounds, Buck E. Dangerously.
Yeah, you look like you're from Hawaii, buddy. It looks like you really, really, really tanned up.
This is
He's
okay.
also stolen your jacket.
Apparently.
This,
what the fuck is...
This character is not entirely one of those just roleplay characters, because Buck wanted the Mankind mask because Mick Foley is his favorite wrestler of all the times. So he wanted Mankind's mask. And the rest of it fell into place alongside it. I asked him if he wanted a graphic. He saw the huge fucking dragon graphic and he said, put it on the coat. So I did. It doesn't look half bad. Also, I really, really like his singlet. His singlet looks great on him, I think. It really fits together.
So I have a question, James. Why the fuck don't you have a tail?
Because I'm not an...
Wrecked!
This is a serious question, because you're the fucking squirrel dude. I'm like, why the fuck don't you have a tail?
Want to know why? Because it clips through the fucking ring.
There you go. Good answer. Good answer, James. Good answer. Regardless, now both of these men are pretty much even so far, but it is just the initial, just kind of grab bag period of the initial match, trying to fight for early dominance. James, who do you think is going to win and why?
This is a question no man can answer, because these two men are, well, fine, I'll say it, they're nuts. Happy.
Get it? Because he's a squirrel.
Fucking, where's the air horn sound effect when I need it? Well done, James. I appreciate that. Thank you. So, fun fact, though, about Bucky Dangerously, his moveset is almost a carbon copy of Cactus Jack's moveset, right down to his main finisher, the Stump Puller Pile Driver, which was Cactus Jack's finisher.
I think I'm gonna lean more to Junkachu, personally. I think Junkachu has, like, the faster arsenal, but I will give credit to Buck, because this dude is fucking weird. He's got all sorts of weird moves like that, so you never know what he's gonna pull out, which might weird the fuck out of Junkachu.
Ooh, great fireman scary flapjack right there.
Not sunny side up.
Certainly not.
You know, dude, if he wins this match, like, the next match he should go to, you should make it, like, Extreme Rules or something.
I don't know. We'll have to see. I know my plan for the... I already have my plan done for day two. The wheel is going to be filled with stipulations, but half of them are just going to be normal matches. So that way, if we get a stipulation, it's special. It's not going to be stipulation, yeah. stipulation, you know?
Right.
Stipulation matches should be special and saved for special occasions.
Yep, or they can just be random, one of the two. But the thing is, I can't exactly, like, in the tournament, I'd prefer it to be random chance because I don't want to save specific stipulations for specific matches and kind of play favorites, you know? If it's random, then it's... Wow, great sit-out powerbomb from Junkachu.
Batista bomb!
Anyway, we should get back to the match. Right now, Junkachu looks to be the early favorite, but Bucky Dangerously shows that he's still around and still ready to play. Ooh, wow, that was quick!
Nice.
The thing is, Junkachu gets some offense, but then as he starts to get on that roll, he gets countered.
What is Junkachu's finisher? Iron Tail, Thunderball, Electric Tackle? Jesus.
That is not what it actually is.
The gimmick is strong with this one.
So, Junkachu's main signature is the swinging elbow leg drop, or a swinging elbow drop, I should say. It's set up with a body slam. And his finisher is a move that a lot of you might be familiar with if you watched Ring of Honor over the last year, the Lethal Injection.
Ah, yes. It's a fun move. You backflip into the ropes, and you just so happen to hope you'll be in the right place to hit him with the cutter. That's the thing that always bothered me about that move. Like, you do a backflip into the ropes, and then you have to hope and pray that they're still standing in that one spot.
Or you're good enough and know that they're gonna be there.
No, still, it is a good move. Hmm. He also has an imploding 450 splash. Dare I ask what an imploding 450 splash is?
It's a 450 splash, but backwards.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, basically in the opposite direction.
It is insanity. Here's the thing. The correct name is the Imploding 450 Splash, but I like to call it the Ow, fuck my knees! Why did I use this as my finisher? Fuck my knees! Goddamn!
Well, let's hope we
see. Junkachu right now is looking for his first signature. There's the body slam! Swinging elbow drop!
Boom! Connected.
That right there is his first signature, and he's looking to put Bucky dangerously away with it as well. Cover, hooks the leg. No, not good enough.
Nice.
Went for the senton and missed. Maybe.
Whoa, that's so big,
first.
Though. Do you want to know what Bucky was trying to do? He was trying to rally. He was trying to rally, and he's going to get denied and hit by the lethal injection. Those 10 seconds.
Big mistake, I think, on his part.
He's already up and moving, so...
Those 10 seconds, though, so huge from Bucky Dangerously. He was trying to rally, but couldn't. He could not.
Oh boy, here we go. Good old classic. Good old classic.
Oh! No! Ooh. Bucky Dangerously just noped Junkachu out of existence.
Hashtag nope.
I love that we're calling these nopes now.
Bucky Dangerously did something huge and countered Junkachu's probably suicide dive or Topegon Hero, whichever one he was going for, but regardless, it didn't happen. Great scouting by Buck, but now, unfortunately, Junkachu is ahead again. He had a chance there, but he's not taking it. As Junkachu goes down, cover, hooks the leg. No! Again, Junkachu ahead. I think Bucky Dangerously is trying to play that patience game again. But both these guys are absolutely exhausted.
Bucky can't just keep waiting for Junkachu to make a mistake. He needs to capitalize when he does get a reversal.
Okay, this is big. Junkachu's going to the top rope, but Bucky Dangerously is up. Yes! That right there is what he was looking for. And now, ooh, that's it. This is a move that he made himself. Backbreaker into a gutbuster. That is
nice.
Called the love of mankind, and he's looking to do something big with that. But he still cannot put Junkachu away.
It's pretty even so far.
And I believe that is his first pin.
Possibly. I'm not sure. But now he's looking to go up top. Whoa, Junkachu looks to rally.
Jesus.
Perfect moment there. Holy crap. What great timing there from Junkachu.
Ooh.
Hangman DDT.
Ridiculous. But now Junkachu has also sacrificed his comeback. This is the first time that this has happened, where neither wrestler is able to get their comeback maneuver off. So, Bucky Dangerously losing his is now null and void because Junkachu could not use his.
Irish whip into the corner. And by the looks of it, Tree of Woe? Maybe?
Nope. Oh, he blocked it. He's going for something. Flying clothesline.
Jinx, you owe me a soda.
That was perfect, Jinx. That was so perfect. Oh, wow. That did not look pleasant. And Junkachu now setting it up again. There's the body drop. Can he get the swinging elbow drop? Yes, he can.
Another elbow drop.
Pin from Junkachu. Will this do it here? No.
Nope. No.
It's not very effective.
It's not. It's a good way to set up to finishers, but it's not exactly a move that will win you matches. It's good for going into other things. Oh, no!
Oh, boy, he's shot. He's calling it. But what will it be?
He's going for the stump puller pile driver!
Oh!
And there's a reason that's banned in WCPW and WWE.
Because that shit hurts. All right, he's going for it. I think it was super effective, maybe. Whoa!
Oh, are pile drivers banned in WCPW as well?
Yeah, storyline-wise, yes, but people still do it.
Oh, okay. Right. Neat.
Yes.
Whoop.
Ooh, Buck, good, well scouted there from Buck. And he's calling for another one? Are you fucking kidding me? What? This close in succession, there's a second stump puller pile driver!
Two of them!
It's over.
Oh my god.
That's... What the
just
fuck?
Just pin him. Just...
No, he's going to the top now. That is a huge mistake, Buck. Big mistake.
Oh,
elbow drop.
Elbow drop.
Buck looking to bring the pain, but he's not pinning him. What is wrong with him? He just wants more, but he's not getting it. Junkachu denies him. Now Junkachu brings him over to the ropes. Irish Rip reversed.
Oh,
lethal injection.
Shit. Oh, shit. Lethal injection.
I can't believe it. Buck E. Dangerously just threw that match away.
One, two, three.
Oh, my God. That was super effective.
That was the dumbest thing I've ever seen in my life. Two pile drivers within 2 minutes of each other, and he refused to pin. I don't know if it was anger or nerves or what, but he could not get the job done, and he deserved to lose that. I'm saying it right now.
He should have pinned.
That he should have gone straight for the pin, just like bam, pile driver, just scoop right down to the pin. It would have been over there, but it gave Junkachu just enough time to get himself back up and hit another lethal injection for the win.
Here's the first one where we thought, okay, it might be over here. And
this is where it actually was over.
Yeah, this is where it was over, and I think we can all agree that Bucky threw this away.
I think he wanted to do a little bit more. I think the little crazy part of him decided, no, I want more. And in doing so, he kind of fucked up there.
Tune, don't talk over Bobby.
Sorry, my video froze.
Okay, so regardless, Junkachu moves on. Kind of surprising. I don't know if a lot of people were rooting for him, but he goes over Bucky Dangerously because Bucky Dangerously isn't it.
Come on. I wouldn't say that. He was doing really good up until the end.
He was, but he... All it takes is one. One mistake. That's it. That's all it takes, and it's over. So, unfortunately, Bucky Dangerously had it, and now Junkachu has it.
Next time, Danger Noodle. Next time.
All right, so... Let me look here. I think it doesn't seem anybody else is available, so you two can stay on if you'd like.
That's fine by me.
Okay.
All right. So, we go on to the seventh match, the second-to-last match of the night. Let me know when you guys have got it all ready.
I'm ready.
Let me just get it to zero, because my media player just instantly plays it and doesn't wait for me to press play.
I think every media player does that. All right, so... Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Okay. 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. So the next match, as you guys should remember from the bracket, is going to be Nelson Demifer, your fan representative, and Gabriel, your current Haymakers World Champion. I wonder who the favorite is here.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from Queens, New York, weighing in at 235 pounds, Nelson Demifer.
And this is Nelson Demifer.
I have a question, and this is a very important question. What if he wins? And
now,
I don't mean just wins, I mean gets the title.
Here, wins the actual tournament, right?
Wins the whole thing.
Then I'm gonna have to change his entrance and his attire to make him look a little bit more serious. But here's the thing. During the preliminary matches, this guy is devastating. Seriously, Nelson is not one to trifle with. He was even more devastating before I nerfed the catching finishers. Like, seriously, that catching finisher, he would not lose. So keep your eye on Nelson as he faces our current reigning Haymakers World Champion.
And his opponent, from Boston, Massachusetts, representing Vicious Delicious, weighing in at 191 pounds, he is your Haymakers World Champion, Gabriel!
Gabriel is the first actual Haymakers World Champion. Voice held the belt as a final boss for the last, for the previous tournament, but it is not an official reign and is not recognized by the Haymakers. Gabriel is your first champion after winning the Haymakers Tournament Spectacular. And he looks to do it a second time here.
All the pressure is on Gabriel here. If he wins, he stays the champion. He just needs to lose two times, and it's over for his title reign.
Yeah.
He could lose this match and then his next match, and we will have a new champion.
100%. This is big right now for Gabriel. But
this is so weird because Silver didn't even who was the last person in the main tournament to get to the finals. He's not even in this now. He's in the loser's bracket. Imagine if he gets eliminated and Gabe gets eliminated. It sets a whole new playing field for everything.
Absolutely, right there, the title will be up for grabs for basically anybody. It'll be pretty much an even shot, and in a way, it'll make things more exciting. But in another way, Gabe's the champ. He should make it to the finals. We'll have to see what happens here. Ooh, Shin. Wow, lots of striking there from. Wow, that was actually very, very brilliant strategy. That right there put a seed in Nelson's brain. Gabe told Nelson that he could strike when he wants, where he wants, at any time ever. I mean, striking in the middle of chain wrestling like that, that's. You usually do that to end a chain wrestling period, you don't do it in the middle of it. That's crazy.
Well, it looks like in this case, Nelson's the underdog here. He is literally representing the fans, and we have the champ here. So this is some Rocky shit right here. And it's one of the opening matches. So this is going to be a match to watch.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, Gabriel. Oh, shit. Hammer throw into the turnbuckle. And Gabe right there answering back.
Roll into a kick.
Now remember, Gabriel's main finisher is the Red Arrow. He usually defaults to the Canadian Destroyer, which is his other finisher, because in the first tournament, he did the Red Arrow several times, but it only hit once. So he usually does the Canadian Destroyer instead. Nelson counters there. Very good job. But the one time that it hit, the one time, actually was the final move in the entire tournament. Spinebuster! So
you know it's effective.
Not only is it effective, but you know that if he hits it, the match is over. It's done. It is the rainmaker of the Haymakers.
Boo.
Nelson's still staying in. Oh, Gabe counters.
Pretty even so far.
Counter Nobody's... after counter.
Yeah.
Nope after nope.
I think that joke has sailed. Sorry,
it
Toon.
Sailed and now it's sinking.
Burn.
I will stay on the ship till it goes down.
Alright, also remember, guys, I should clarify in case anybody's thinking, this is a non-title match. Woo! Gabriel, swing and a miss. That, oh, and swing and a miss there. Wow, what the fuck is happening?
Botchamania.
I don't know if that's just botch or if that's feints, if they're feinting each other. Like F-E-I-N-T.
I definitely think it's feinting.
Oh, wow, quick kick out from Gabe. Still a lot of gas in the tank. Y'all a bunch of puppets.
Snap, what's it called again?
It's
Snapper Neckbreaker.
Yeah, there we go, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
So, I should clarify, I should finish my point. If Nelson does win this, he does not get the title. This is a non-title match. At this point, the only way Gabriel can lose the title is if he loses in the final match or if he is eliminated from the tournament. If he loses in the final match, then the title goes to his victor, as you would think, but if he is eliminated from the tournament, then the title is vacated and whoever is in the finals will and wins that will be winning the championship.
Now,
Nikki actually brought up a point. Nikki said, how does Nelson not have a full Nelson slam as one of his signatures?
Probably because that's a normal move in a lot of movesets. Either that, or it's going to look like the skull crushing finale, and it wouldn't fit Nelson.
All right, fair enough.
And it also would be a very bad joke.
Yes, it also would be a very bad joke. It'd be a decent joke.
Ooh.
It'd be a great joke if he was a wrestler. Like if
okay,
it was wrestling.
Okay, hi, we're seeing up the skirt there. Lovely. can we move him a little bit to the left, please?
It's okay, the rope is blocking our view, and now it isn't.
Wait, no! He's doing the unprettier! Ooh!
Kill switch!
Oh, okay. You do not Nikki me, Toon. I will murder you! 1, 2! Not good enough. So, the unprettier or kill switch is Nelson's... excuse me. It is Nelson's signature right there. So... just letting you know why I got so excited.
Why we got all excited. Also, Northern Lights suplex.
Yes. Ooh, standing corkscrew moonsault. Ooh.
Jesus, that's impressive.
Yes, that right there is Gabriel's signature. No good. All right. Gabriel brings him into the corner. Ooh, no, what?
What?
Oh, corner DDT.
Shades of Sami Zayn!
Beautiful.
Listen to that crowd.
Very nice.
That right there, I think that's set. I think definitively we now have Gabe, ahead of Nelson right there with that move.
Yeah.
That's so devastating.
And once again, people taking it to the outside. Whoever is dominant on the outside has a clear advantage.
Remember, that's also in the game, it's called an OMG moment.
What the?
That's Gabe's looking to rally. Gabe looking to rally here. That might be able to get it. Yes, he does. That's big.
There we go.
But yes, the Torpedo DDT, which is what it's actually called, is an OMG moment, which is one of Gabriel's OMG moments. James, you actually have that as well. So things like table finishers, things like other stuff like that. Oh, wow, he's going for consequence. That's his primary finisher. And if you guys haven't ever seen a devastating finisher in your life, you're about to see one.
Here we go. Oh, God, right in the neck. My
Holy
neck felt that too.
Shit, that is one of Nelson's finishers here. Cover, hooks the leg.
One, two.
And what? Holy fuck! Are you kidding me?
What?
No, what? Oh.
Did he just...
The champion is in the loser's bracket.
Oh my god!
What the fuck?!
If I want to get to that title, I may have to go through Gabe.
Okay! That was a major upset. Let it be known in this match that Gabe wasn't able to hit any of his finishers!
Well, here's the thing. He used a finisher to do the torpedo DDT, so saying that is false. But regardless, Nelson, with one finisher, put away the champion, making him easily the single most feared wrestler on the tournament bracket right now. Watch this man.
Here is your winner, Nelson Dimmyfer.
Upset of the fucking night.
Jesus fucking Christ. No. Be scared of this man. He just pinned the champion in his first match. What the fuck?
This just changes everything.
I'm glad I'm not Bucky, because we all know who he's facing now.
No, he's actually not going to be facing Bucky. Bucky will be facing Geeky Steven.
Everyone's yes. going, okay, we got a hashtag going, hashtag fear the spaghetti.
Nelson will be facing the winner of the next and final match. And you two can stay on, because nobody else is asking. So, that's fine. You two can stay on for the final match of the... Jesus fucking Christ, I can't believe it.
That... I can't believe it either.
...was insanity.
Can we get Gabe's reaction? Can we bring him in here for his reaction?
Hold on.
Is Gabe around?
He is in the chat. He is watching right now. His username is Gooberplex. So if he's on Skype, I might be able to bring him in here for a moment.
Oh, Jesus. He might have rage quit after that.
This is... Holy shit. I think he may have to. Hold on. I gotta.
Oh, thank you, Silverstone. Silverstone says he's digging a commentary us free.
Yeah, I actually think we do really well. I'm the hype guy. Toon is the joke guy. James is the technical guy. It works. Yay.
Yeah.
Also, my voice is almost gone.
Join the club. And I have a show in about 6 hours.
Yeah, dude. You're going to be ripping and raring to go.
We got people saying, we the viewers.
We the viewers! Hold on, I've got the right shirt for it. We the people.
Also, I blame you. I blame you so much. I may or may not have got the mystery box for 5 t-shirts.
I did. Jesus, are you kidding me? I bought that shit. Yeah. That was awesome.
Yeah, I'm saying it's your fault. I got the...
Oh!
I saw your video and I was like, I don't mind having 5 t-shirts.
Okay, so while we load up the last match, which is Josh versus Voice, while we load it up, everybody in the chat, all at the same time, say, we, the viewers, okay? On go, okay? On go. I'm going to give you about 10 to 15 seconds to type it out, okay?
All right.
I just give you a little bit of time to just type it out, but don't say enter yet, okay? All right?
All right.
I think that's enough time. So everybody, 3, 2, 1, we, the viewers!
The viewers!
You forget that they are in a stream delay of about 20 seconds.
Well, fuck you.
All right, I want to see the chat. I want to see this before we start the final match.
Hey!
Yay!
Hey, there we go.
Yeah, thank you guys so much for that. All right, so without further ado, I think we should start our final match of the evening between two of the biggest big men in the Haymakers Federation, Josh Scorcher versus Voice of Reason. And I will finally get to explain a few things that I've wanted to explain throughout the night, especially since Voice is a big part of that. So, James, you ready?
Yes.
Toon, you ready?
Yes, I am.
All right. Final match of the night. Night one. Let's see how it ends. Three, two, one, go. This is Josh Scorcher versus Voice of Reason. This entrance actually fits him really well.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, weighing in at 249 pounds, Josh Scorcher!
Josh Scorcher is a military man, and if I am not mistaken, he is the only military man in the tournament. So
I believe so, yes.
Okay. And as such, I had to make him bigger than everybody else.
Of course.
So, guys in the chat, before the final match starts, I just want to ask, did you guys have a good time? Was it fun? Was it worth
it? Was it good for you?
Yeah. Was it as good for you as it was for me? Sound off in the chat. Let me know. I also want to hear your comments, your concerns, any suggestions you have. If you have a decent idea, let me know. I want to know because as much at work as I put into it and as good as I think it is, it can always be better, so I'd like to know.
Man, he got his jacket off real quick.
Yeah, cool, Chris 9. Don't worry about it, because this will be on YouTube by Sunday at the latest.
And his opponent, from Long Island, New York, representing the Saints of Smart, weighing in at 242 pounds, Voice of Reason!
Now, Voice of Reason has a thing around his waist. That thing is the National, or Haymakers National Championship. That was the prize in the Haymakers Gold Rush Tournament that unfortunately cannot be aired now because the video is just kaput. It's destroyed, it's corrupt, it's gone. But he won the tournament with a catching shell shock on Stephen A.D. In fact, that is the reason why I took out catching finishers, because I did a little bit of experimenting, and I learned that catching finishers make high flyers completely 100% useless, because the AI will always do a catching finisher if they get the chance. And the kicker is that you cannot kick out of a catching finisher. You can't. It's not possible. And as such, I had to remove everybody's catching finisher. And I'm even thinking of stripping Voice of the title, because that move is, in fact, illegal. It is the only illegal move in the Haymakers Wrestling Federation. But for now, I'll let him keep it because it looks pretty nice on him. I'd like to think the belt looks pretty good. But away we go. Josh Scorcher versus Voice of Reason.
I honestly think it would have a better name of the international title.
I was debating on international, but international sounds too much like intercontinental.
Yes, I was also making a reference to me
to the fact, to the fact that, yes, to the fact that you're not American. Good for you, you goddamn Aussie. Go back to the Great Barrier Reef. Go back to the Great Barrier Reef where you belong.
I could. It's just like a short walk away.
Go
literally.
Back to the fucking woods and play with your nuts. I don't know.
What the fuck is that? Dude, it's Australia. Australia doesn't have woods.
We have the bush, which is far
better. Okay, fine.
I love how you said bush.
I don't know.
I love how you said you don't have bushes. You have a bush.
just a
bush.
A singular bush.
And right behind it, a kangaroo was fucking a dingo.
No, it's just like, it doesn't quite have a good ring to it. From the one bush in Australia. Fucking Jesus, squirrel theorist.
Okay, I'm done with the xenophobia. We're done here. Nothing like a little bit of xenophobia to make your stream world class. But regardless, we just missed the first 2 minutes of the action. Fortunately, though, the first 2 minutes of the action, the only exciting thing was the hammer throw Josh did to the outside, which may not have been wise.
Ooh. And there goes, like, military training's great and all, but once you get your head slammed into a ring post, that doesn't mean much.
Little mini stare down there as they both run into the wall. Ooh, right to the eyes to get out of that. Voice playing a little dirty here as Voice does a hammer throw now to get Josh out of the ring. And Voice being a little safe here goes out on the outside on the other side of the ring.
For a second there, I thought he was going to go for the stairs, but that would get him in DQ.
Oh, James, don't mind Steven AD in the chat. He is obsessed with trying to get his hands on Forza Horizon 3. And so he's going to be asking you a lot of questions about whether the game is geographically accurate.
They did it again.
That would make...
Welcome to being the only non-American in the Federation, James. How does it fucking feel?
It's great. The ladies love me. The ladies love an accent. It's all true. You all know it.
They love your nuts.
Okay, you can stop now, Toon. Toon, you are being a little bitch. Oh, fuck. Ooh. All right,
you
back to the...
tink, that little thud.
Back to the match. Josh Scorcher putting on a clinic on Voice of Reason outside of the ring near the steel steps. Great punches and striking there from Josh Scorcher. Two punches into a neck breaker.
Someone is asking, why does Voice look like Aquaman?
Voice looks like Aquaman because I don't fucking know. He just does. Roll with it.
Something I might suggest for round two would be having the count appear on the screen.
Yeah.
The ring count. Here's the thing. If the referee is not in picture, I can't tell myself. Because you need to be able to hear the referee in order to get the count if he's not on screen. And because turning off Michael Cole, Jerry Lawler, and JBL, and Jillian Hall, turning them off also turns the referee off, well, there's unfortunately nothing I can do about that.
You said yes, Jillian Hall, what the fuck?
Lillian Garcia, sorry. Bleh, similar name. Whoa, ref is down!
What the fuck?
Ref bump.
What's going on here?
I don't know. I think Josh broke. I think... Oh, you know what? You want to know what he was doing? Josh is trying to go up the top rope, but he can't. That's what Josh wants. Yeah. Josh wants to go off the top rope, but he is not able to.
Just so you know, there is an option in the settings where pinfalls and ring out counts will... A little graphic will appear, but you still won't hear them.
Are you fucking kidding me? I spent hours trying to devise a solution as to how to count the pinfalls, and you tell me now there's just a fucking visual count option?
Yes.
Oh, that's great.
What'd you do?
Wait, no, there's Josh with an Olympic slam! That's one of his signatures right there. One of his signatures. Josh smells blood, goes for the pin. 1, 2. No, not good enough.
And as we said earlier, we know who the winner and loser of this match is facing.
They're facing the dominant monster. No, he might just win. Okay, guys. Josh's finisher is called the Omega Driver, and it looks like this. It looks like this.
Ow!
Yeah! Voice ain't kicking out of that. Holy fucking shit. Cover.
One,
hooks the leg.
Two,
this is over.
Three.
Whoa! What?
No.
kidding me? And Voice even still has enough energy to counter that. What?
Okay. So, Gutbuster.
Wow, I'm still in awe that he kicked out of that. But regardless,
yeah.
Voice right now doing pretty well.
Toon's so shocked he hasn't spoken in a while.
Toon. Whoa, brogue kick! Big fucking brogue kick right there.
One, two.
Oh no, not good enough. Wow. So, I guess it's just us. I don't know where Toon is. Ooh, good knee lift right there from Josh. But an even better counter there from Voice, and an even better snapmare.
Into that rear naked. Couple of shots to the gut freeze up Voice from Scorcher.
And now we're going to a rest hold here. Match has been pretty intense, but Voice needs to land a big, big fucking move here. He's got one, but I don't think that's going to do it against Josh. And now there's another hammer throw outside. Oh, hello, Toon.
Yeah, yay, sorry, I had to run downstairs to grab something. I'm okay.
Yay, okay. Good. Even if something wasn't okay, I still wouldn't care because we're doing this right now.
Screw it, we're live.
Doing it live.
So yes, right now Josh landed the Omega Driver, and you remember what that looks like.
Yes. Yeah. Once again, they're back outside again. This match has been, I believe, more action outside the ring than inside the ring.
Seems like it. Lots of hammer throws just right outside. I think, if anything, I think both of them are just trying to win by count out. Because right now the count is up to 7. Ref's not counting. There's 8. The voice gets in.
Ooh, backslide. No, not a backslide. Oh,
and he's setting it up for the discus. Big boot. This is a unique move here.
Ooh.
That is a finisher and
one,
a half.
Two.
Ooh. Nope.
Not good enough. Stephen AD, I will cut you. Stephen AD, do not ever call me Palkos. Okay, you want to know what? I accidentally miscalled a move during the Gold Rush tournament. Toon Critic referred to me as Colkos, and he's going to get murdered too.
That was fucking hilarious, though. Come on.
No. God damn it. No. Voice is looking to rally, and Voice gets the rally successful. Here's the Undertaker move condition, the combination. Body splash into a snake eyes, and then runs off the ropes, big boot, and then off the ropes again into a leg drop. Yay, great, Voice. Oh my goodness. Now Voice brings him up.
Is that a little bit of salt I detected in your tone, sir?
No, just not salt, but just more anger at all the friggin' nicknames. No, not anger. It's actually
one,
okay. I think it's funny.
Two.
So that was a
no.
That was
a bro kick. That was a signature right there.
Correct. I forget what his other signature is because he never fucking uses it. Oh yeah, no, he totally does. Yeah.
Uh-oh. He's setting it up.
He actually doesn't. It's the chicken wing gut buster that he has as a signature, but now he's going for a scorpion death drop.
Ooh.
SDD! Think that just might be it for Voice. 1, 2. 3! That is it!
That's it!
Your national champion moves on to the second round of the winner's bracket!
He wants to hold all the singles gold.
Yes, absolutely. And with that win, he is on the path. Josh Scorcher is still on the path as well. He is only in the loser's bracket, but he must take a different path there. That's the Omega Driver! God, that move is so fucking cool. God damn.
Yes, but it will never see the light of day in the WWE.
I hate that, dude. It looks so fucking cool. It's sort of like when Andre the Giant would do a rotating tombstone piledriver in his prime, back when he could actually move in the late 70s, early 80s. Like, look up videos of him doing the fucking...
Winner,
Voice of Reason.
Look up those videos. They're amazing.
Yes, back when he had a set of knees.
Yeah, exactly. Regardless, Voice moves on. Josh has another shot on night two. So now, with all of the matches out of the way, I may as well introduce you to the final night one Haymakers bracket. The first match...
This is where we have to go, because we don't have access to this bracket, to the stream to watch it with you guys.
Correct. So the first winner's bracket match is going to be Nikki V versus Acharki. Nikki V going over Silverstone and Acharki winning against Bobby. The second winner's bracket match is going to be Steven AD versus Toon Critic. Steven AD going over Kirk Davis. Toon Critic going over James, the Squirrel Theorist. Kalkos and Junkachu will be fighting each other. Kalkos beating Geeky Steven. Junkachu beating Buck E. Dangerously. And Nelson Demifer, who beat Gabe, still shocked about that. He will be going up against Voice of Reason, who just right now beat Josh Scorcher. And in the loser's bracket, which you can see right here, the first loser's bracket match is going to be Silverstone versus Bobby. The second one is going to be Kirk Davis versus James the Squirrel Theorist. The third one is going to be Geeky Steven versus Bucky Dangerously. And the fourth one is going to be our champion Gabriel versus Josh Scorcher. Remember, if you lose a loser's bracket match, you are out of the tournament for good. So don't do that. But those are your brackets, ladies and gentlemen.
Here's a question about the loser's bracket. How does that work? So I'm just looking at it. The winner of this first round losers bracket go into the finals of the losers bracket, and then, or is it just the winners of the losers bracket goes into the final?
The grand
eight?
Finals. Yes, exactly. So how
does
it works,
turn into a triple threat, basically?
No, it doesn't. Here's the thing: there's two brackets. There's a winners bracket and a losers bracket, and the losers of this current match will fight each other. And then they'll face the losers of the next set of winners' matches. That's how it'll work. If that makes any sense. If that doesn't make sense, then I have an idea.
No, that makes sense. The question is, and this is a important question, if someone doesn't lose until they get into the finals, are we going to have a repeat of what happened last tournament, or is there just going to be one finals match?
There's going to be one finals match, and the reason for that is because I'd have to do... Here's the thing. If we ran into a situation where the winner was... A person in the winner's bracket was Gabe, and the person in the loser's bracket was anybody, then if the loser won, then he'd get the championship. And then if the person in the winner's bracket won back, then he'd win the tournament and then win the championship back. And I didn't want to have to deal with that problem of trading championships back and forth. Yeah, I didn't want to deal. I've run tournaments before, so I know how all this works. Normally, under normal conditions, because in the grand finals, the person who is in the winner's bracket will face the person who wins the loser's bracket. And the loser has to win twice. The person in the loser's bracket has to win twice because the person in the winner's bracket has yet to lose. And you must lose twice in order to be eliminated from the tournament. So that's how double elimination works. You get a second try, but it's harder to win. In this case, I had to eliminate that factor altogether. So the person who wins the loser's bracket actually has a decent advantage. So, yeah. No bracket resetter. And pressure is on the person that completes the winner's bracket, not the loser's bracket. But I also put a graphic in the Twitch chat in case you haven't seen it, and you can take a look at that and you'll see how it works.
Man, this has been one hell of a first day.
Yeah, no kidding.
So basically, for the people at home, and that part with the dotted line, we're not having that.
Yeah. We had that last time, but last time I didn't have a championship really to divvy out. This time I do, and it's a bit of a problem, but that's okay. It makes things more exciting in the end of the day. So, night two of the Haymakers Tournament Spectacular will likely take place 2 weeks from now, so that way Nikki has time to make a trailer for it. So in 2 weeks, either on Friday or Saturday night, we will be doing a second one of these, and hopefully we'll have more commentators available to go ahead. But I think the swapping out worked pretty well. We were able to have how many commentators, not including myself? Quite a few. So I'm glad that everything worked out. This went off with almost without a hitch, and I am super grateful to every single person that helped me out with this, which there's quite a lot of people, actually. I may have put in over 100 hours into this tournament, but that's not on my own. So I want to thank Bobby for doing the voiceover work. I want to thank Nikki for doing the trailer. I want to thank all the guys who uploaded the promos to the Haymakers channel. I want to thank all of you guys that helped me with commentary, making things more exciting and allowing me to have somebody to play off of. And I want to thank all of you guys in the Twitch chat, all of you guys that watched the stream and interacted with us and enjoyed the show, because without you guys, we would not exist. We would not be just sitting there recording podcasts and doing this tournament for ourselves, because that's just borderline narcissistic. No, we do this for you. It's you guys that make this possible. So thank you so much for your undying devotion and your support. Night 2 will happen in 2 weeks, and we will release a trailer on our YouTube channel. If you follow our Twitters, our Tumblrs, you will know when it comes out. Subscribe to us on YouTube. Subscribe to me on Twitch. In fact, I do stream every so often things other than this. So you can subscribe here, and if you see an email that says, Haymakers Tournament Spectacular, then you know, oh shit, I gotta get online. So definitely, definitely, definitely subscribe, follow our Twitters, and most of all, keep listening, because it drives us. It really does. There's a reason why I read every single one of your YouTube comments. But without further ado, Toon, go ahead and say goodbye.
Yep, I just also really want to quickly say, when I created this podcast, I had no idea that it was going to get this big. I thought it would just be some sort of goofy little predictions thing, but me and Nikki and Kalkos, we've turned it into something great, something amazing for all of you to enjoy. So I want to personally thank everyone, too, as the creator of all of this in the beginning. It's gone to such a huge length. Kalkos has put so much effort into this that I'm just amazed by it. I couldn't do this. I'm glad that Kalkos was able to do this to make this so huge. So if you've been joining us for day one, just wait till you get to day two, because shit is about to get bigger. Oh, shit's going to hit the fan, and it's going to go all over the place.
I have ideas. I have ideas. James, would you like to...
That scares me.
James, would you like to say something?
Yeah. It's been great commentating with you guys. I started watching these guys just as a fan, and when they started up the Patreon, I was like, okay, I want to see more of this. If giving them money helps, okay, I've got some spare money. And then I was on one show and I was like, yeah, this was fun. That was, by the way, if you want to see it, that was the Lucha Underground Season 1 video.
Yes.
Yes. Hasn't been one for Season 2.
That's probably because I have seen maybe the first fourth of Lucha Underground Season 2. Now, here's the thing. If you, Toon, and Nikki want to review Season 2 or discuss the initial parts of Season 3 once a few more episodes come out, you're more than welcome to. But I simply do not have the time to watch Lucha Underground. I just don't. At some point, I may start binge-watching Season 3 and watch a compilation of Season 2, because I already know plot details for Season 2, some of them, but I just don't have the time, man. I just don't have the time. All of my energy has been put into making this. So, regardless, guys, thank you so much for coming. I appreciate it. Guys that are watching on YouTube, if you watched on Twitch, thank you for reliving the memories. If you haven't watched on Twitch, What are you doing? Subscribe to my channel. Pay attention to the trailers. Watch it live next time. It's a whole different experience. But as for now, this is Kalkos. This is Toon. This is James. This is Nelson. This is Silver. This is Geeky Steven. Signing off.
See you guys.
See ya.
Oh, boy. That was fun. I'm going to go finish up some stuff for the night. Kalkos.